வணக்கம் பொதிகை ரசிகர்களே, அனைவரும் நலமா? சென்னை அடுத்து இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தையில் ராணுவ அமைச்சகம் பிரம்மாண்டமான முறையில் நடத்தி கொண்டிருக்கும் இந்த ராணுவ கண்காட்சி, அதாவது 10வது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ, ரொம்ப சிறப்பான முறையில இன்னைக்கு ஆரம்பிச்சிருக்கு. இன்னைக்கு முதல் நாளை முன்னிட்டு பாத்தீங்கன்னா ராணுவ மற்றும் விமானப்படை வீரர்களுடைய சாகசங்களை நம்ம நேரலையா பார்க்க இருக்கோம். எப்படி நம்ம பொதிகை தொலைக்காட்சி மூலமாக பார்க்க இருக்கோம். இன்று முதல் நாளை முன்னிட்டு இந்த 10வது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ எதை பத்தி சொல்ல போகுது, என்னென்ன விஷயங்கள்லாம் நம்ம பார்க்க போறோம், அதை முன்னிட்டு ராணுவ அதிகாரிகள் பத்திரிகை மற்றும் ஊடக நண்பர்களை சந்தித்து அது சம்பந்தப்பட்ட சில விஷயங்களை பகிர்ந்துக்க போறாங்க. அதை இப்போ நீங்க பார்க்க போறீங்க, பாருங்க.
Our approach to the Make in India initiative. I would like to emphasize that for us, Make in India is not only manufacture in India. Make in India for us means leveraging all the competencies of the country, including innovation capabilities and engineering capabilities. And we plan to grow these kinds of activities either internally within the Thales Indian subsidiary and with our joint ventures, as well as with our Indian partners. In addition to that, we are seeing the Make in India initiative as a really a good platform to build capabilities to export from India. And exporting from India, we see it in various domains that we have implemented already. So I'm talking of things that are real already today. First of all, it means selecting in the Indian industry a number of partners, and we have already in the Indian industry many partners, SMEs or larger groups that we do not only involve to serve Indian programs, but we involve in our global supply chain. Second element is, of course, through our joint ventures, address not only the Indian market, but also put in place all the necessary competencies to address other markets than India. And what will really appear as a key element is the capability to hire competencies directly in India to staff all these activities. And we are very much appreciative of the Skill India initiative. Thales is trying to contribute to this. We have put in place partnerships with very well recognized institutes of technology or science. We have partnerships, for example, with the Indian Institute of Technology of Delhi, Mumbai, as well as Chennai. That was the last one that was put in place, as well as the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. We are particularly focusing on putting in place PhD fellowship programs with these institutes with the objective then to be able to have in India very well trained, highly skilled engineers. So as you can see, Thales is already very much involved in all these initiatives. We are very appreciative and proud of the confidence that the Indian authorities have placed in Thales in a number of programs. And I can tell you that going forward, we'll continue to be very active in promoting the Make in India initiative. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Before we move on to our next speaker, it gives me great pride and privilege as we welcome Dr. Subhash Bhamre, the Honorable Raksha Rajya Mantri, Ministry of Defense, Government of India. A huge, huge round of applause and a very, very warm welcome to you, sir. Moving on to the next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, we request Sri Pierre D. Bosse, President from Airbus Group, to join us on stage. As time is pressing, we request all of you to kindly have your industry address for 5 minutes. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, as we welcome Sri Pierre D. Bosse.
Thank you very much. Honorable Minister, distinguished civil servants and representatives of the armed forces, peers, partners in the room, good morning to all. We are assembled to celebrate a gathering of the big aerospace and defense family, what we like to call here the ecosystem. With all its categories of institutions and bodies, the ministry, the forces, of course, the DPSUs, large Indian private companies, OEMs, MSMEs, tier one and more, system, equipment, and parts providers. But just as important is the metabolism of that ecosystem, and that's what we are here to talk about. The ability to fund relevant research and development, to draw foreign direct investment, to encourage long-term industrial investment and risk-taking, to instill excellency in program management, supply chain management, and quality management, to nurture talents in anticipation of the needs of tomorrow and of the day after, to be inclusive of the most innovative MSMEs in the country and the startups, to create jobs, to generate a sustainable, competitive, profitable industry, and of course, tax revenues for the Indian government. In India, we are blessed with a government that applies a lot of efforts to thinking and to consulting with us, industry, just for that purpose. The draft DPP 2018 goes exactly to show that. I say we because companies, Airbus, but all foreign OEMs in country as well, are striving to prove that they are one of you, that they can be good corporate citizens in India, that they can work by your rules, and that we have your interest at heart. The ambitious goals set by the government for turnover and exports are reassuring. They're remarkable, but they're reassuring because they imply, obviously, that the missing ingredients will be there, primarily orders and budgets over the long term, applied to the most meaningful infrastructure and segments. Reading the draft DPP, I saw a lot of improvements favoring MSMEs, rationalizing entry conditions for startups, simplifying procedures, opening further to FDI. I wish the efforts devoted to managing offsets obligations will extend to managing offset credits as well. I hope the automatic route to 74% FDI will extend beyond just niche technologies, but will also apply to companies that contribute to jobs, to quality, to complex management practices, and to helping out foreign companies that undertake very demanding delivery commitments and take risk in doing so. I hope that the approach to self-reliance does not turn into an obsession to do everything here alone independently. India has unique differentiation in certain areas, a unique pragmatic and frugal philosophy as well. Investing and focusing on what you do best, where India can dominate the competitive field, and working hand in hand with foreign companies to become part of a global industry, India will attack the global markets meaningfully. That is the surest path. I stick to 5 minutes. I'm sorry, I'll be quick. That is the surest path to realizing your ambitious goals and serving the defense and economic needs of the country over the long term. Congratulations to all, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together as we welcome on stage Sri Pratyush Kumar, the president from Boeing India, to join us on stage, please. We do not have the gentleman here. Quickly moving on, let's welcome Sri Ashish Rajwamsi, the CEO from Adani Defense, to join us on stage, please. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Honorable Minister, Honorable Secretaries, leaders and veterans from the armed forces, officers, industry leaders and friends, good morning to all. Just 12 years from today, in 2030, India will become the world's third largest nation. One critical aspect of being the largest nation is to be minimally dependent on others' nation and have an indigenous defense industry that is strong and able to support not only itself, but also stand in support of many of its friends. Today, we collectively stand on an incredible opportunity to transform the defense landscape for the country. And this opportunity comes with its own set of responsibilities. When we look back in 2030, all of us here should be collectively able to say that we made the difference. And India, that is well on its path of being self-reliant in defense and security sector. We must commend the sincere and intense efforts of the government, which has actually brought all of us together this morning. MOD has been nothing short of extraordinary in bringing together the 44 defense attaches with the aim of tapping the potential for defense exports. This is unprecedented. The defense industrial corridors, which have been planned in Tamil Nadu and UP, showcase the path for the development of several defense industrial ecosystems within the country. The draft Defense Production Policy 2018 is a comprehensive document which not only articulates the 13 flagship programs, but also gives quantitative targets for exports and indigenization. Though ambitious, the targets are achievable if the approach is inclusive. If a level playing field is given to the private sector, the country can benefit the way it has benefited in other sectors, including telecom, aviation, power transmission, and power generation. While we are talking about the defense sector, the extent of R&D which will be driving in this sector and other technologies including cyber, materials, 3D printing, machine-to-machine communication will actually galvanize entirely new ecosystems within India. There is no ecosystem as powerful as defense to spur technology, to spur innovation, and this can potentially put India into a completely different league. Let me give an example from our recent joint venture with our Elbit, with our Israeli partners, Elbit Systems. While the joint venture has been formed to design, manufacture, and support unmanned aerial systems in India, it is not limited to the platform. With Elbit, we are galvanizing the carbon composites and materials ecosystem within the country. There's a team of Indians which is actually in Israel getting trained firsthand by the practitioners on the carbon composites and material technology. They'll be coming back to India in 6 months, and we expect to leverage this technology not only for defense, but for other sectors within India. We are often asked this question, why Adani entered the defense sector? Over the past 3 decades, Adani Group has emerged as India's leading provider of critical infrastructure. It has reinvented itself every 4 to 5 years to stay aligned with the national priorities. The priorities have included energy security, food security, supply chain and logistics, and clean energy as we ventured into ports, power, renewables, solar manufacturing, creating the largest and most efficient business in every sector we entered. Therefore, in line with our vision of nation building, there could not have been a more appropriate sector than defense. While we are working with our global partners on the key platforms, including fighter aircrafts, unmanned aerial systems, and helicopters, we are actively working on the Make 2 programs in radar and electronic warfare. Aligned to Honorable Defense Minister's push to MSMEs, we have already invested and rolled up a couple of MSMEs in our portfolio with world-class capabilities in avionics, systems, components, and composites. In closing, I would like to say, if I look around the room, I see some of the best companies in India and abroad all present here. While we compete with each other, we do so to build a stronger India. And while we compete, we do so to equip the brave guardians of our land, the guardians of our sea and the sky with the best to help secure the lives of 1.3 billion citizens in the country. We at Adani understand our responsibilities and will leave no stone unturned to do our part and help secure the nation. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Now we request Sri Ambar Dubey, the partner from KPMG, to join us on stage, please. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, as we welcome Sri Ambar Dubey to join us on stage.
Namaskar, everyone. And we know time is short and we're waiting for the real person to join us. I'll keep it very short. We are very proud and privileged to be the knowledge partners for this great event at DefExpo and the ASSOCHAM conference. I'll keep it very, very short because the Raksha Mantri is anyway going to release the knowledge paper. And if I give out too much, you'll end up not reading that document. Just a quick one. I think the biggest challenge if we face today is this whole distrust between the public and private, and the document actually talks about that. Unless we bridge this divide, if you look at some of the best armies of the world who are fighting wars all over the place, they actually don't have a DPSU. So while I'm taking nothing away from the DPSU, they've done a great job for our country. I think we have to crush this artificial divide between the public and private. At 4:40 a.m. tomorrow morning, ISRO is actually going to launch a remote navigation satellite, which is actually made by a private company, Alpha Design. They have a big booth here. Please do visit them whenever you get time. And this is the model which we have to somehow get into private sector. We have to cut down the nomination. Right now, a lot of stuff goes into the DPSUs on nomination because sarkar ke apne hi log hain, because we can't trust the private sector. We have to cut down the nomination. If we have to nominate, you actually have to nominate certain programs for the private sector, because they are the ones who have set up modern factories which are not depreciated. Okay, the people cost is high. The cost of capital is high because when we go to the bank, we pay interest. Most of the DPSUs do not, I mean, they're sitting on cash balance. They have almost 8 to 10 years of order book. And if there is a need for any capital infusion, we have you, the Indian taxpayers, to pay for it. So we'll come back to you. Please attack me right after this one. And we'll be very happy to engage in a debate. We're all Indians. We're working for the same Bharat Mata. Next comes this whole equal multipliers. We have this given multipliers to, if you do technology transfer to a DRDO or a DPSU, of three times. Why three times? Why not? If it goes to an Adani or maybe a Reliance or maybe a Tata or a Birla. Next is this priority lending. We have to have priority lending for defense being so critical a sector. If infrastructure can get priority lending, why not a small tiny portion? Let's start with a small portion and get defense manufacturing also into priority lending if you really want to make in India happen. Next, this whole payment structure, this 15, 75, 10, there's a big gap between 15%. Now, 15% not good enough to start, because if you look at the capex, this is the sector. This is not refrigerators or microwave ovens where you can sell to the whole world. If the defense ministry or MOD doesn't buy, we can sell to the rest of the world. Here, we have only one customer. We all know it. We say it in every conference. There's only one customer. So if that one customer, if he doesn't smile at us, we are finished. And with that 15%, not good enough. And the next one is 75%. So between 15 and 75, there's a big gap. The private sector does not have the capability to withstand this kind of a financial pressure. Please consider changing it. Break up that 75 into smaller parts. Next is on this performance guarantee. Now, on the DPSUs, no performance guarantee. Apne log hain. But this whole 10% plus 10%, and if you add 2.5 to 4% of the charges on that bank guarantee, I mean, where will the people run away? I mean, somebody like an L&T, if they've set up a Kattupalli or a Hazira, where will they run away if they don't perform? And every years of delay adds up to that interest charge on that bank guarantee. That takes away the entire profit. Next, last 3 points on cost escalation on the DPSU side, because apne hain. So anything, any cost escalation which happens just gets written off by the check because you're paying it, you're the taxpayers. The silent taxpayers who doesn't expect any return. In terms of private sector, even if you add another extra rupee, CAG aa jayega. Why? Because, I mean, you're a private sector and the whole bidding has happened. So maybe we need to sit down together. These are not easy questions and answers which can be resolved in a 5 minute rushed speech. These require both the government and the private sector and the public sector, like we've done in space and nuclear, where we've gone far, far ahead, where we're only lamenting in defense, but we've done it. We have proved it in space and nuclear. Let's just sit together, work together, and work for this great country. Last but not the least, and I know I'm going to upset Mr. Purva Chandra, who's a great, my senior from IIT, but we need to have an arm's length between MOD and the DPSUs. The same people who are also in this conference guiding us, helping us, facilitating Make in India, are also sitting on the boards of the very DPSUs, who are actually our competitors in a way and facilitators on another way. But so this sort of a mini conflict of interest may be something which we need to cut down on. And of course, last but not the least, let's communicate. Thank you so much. Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, sir, for completing the moment for all of us. Now moving on, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us to welcome Admiral Sri Sunil Lamba, PVSM, AVSM, ADC Chairman, Chief of Staff Committee, to give the keynote address for all of us. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, for Admiral Sri Sunil Lamba on stage, please.
Dr. Subhash Bhamre, Honorable Rajya Raksha Mantri, General Bipin Rawat, the Chief of Army Staff, Chairman, ASCOCHAM, Captain of Indian Industries, representatives from the global defense industries, conveners and organizers of this seminar, distinguished invitees, speakers, delegates, friends from the media, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all of you. It's an honor and privilege for me to deliver the keynote address at the 9th ASCOCHAM International Conference on Aerospace and Defense. At the outset, I'd like to thank the Association of Chambers of Commerce and Indian Industry of India for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts. I would also like to compliment ASCOCHAM India for the active role in promoting the Indian defense industry. I'm sure that this platform will provide ideal opportunities for meaningful discussions toward charting the way ahead for bolstering Make in India in the defense sector, and help formulate an incisive strategy for achieving self-reliance in the defense sector. It's a matter of great pride for the Indian Navy that we started our quest of self-reliance and indigenization soon after independence. Since then, shipbuilding industry in the country has come of age and has built state-of-the-art stealth frigates, corvettes, and destroyers. The Indian naval ships, designed in India, constructed in Indian shipyards, have carried the Indian tricolor across the ocean. I remember when I commanded Mumbai destroyer made in India and we went overseas for the International Fleet Review in UK. People were surprised that India could build ships of that size and quality and capability. The Navy is indeed proud of the fact that all 33 platforms ranging from submarines to aircraft carriers, which are currently ordered, are being built by Indian shipyards. In fact, our last induction, INS Kiltan, the third of the Project 28 anti-submarine warfare corvette, commissioned in October last year, had an indigenous content of about 90%. It's been our endeavor to progressively increase the indigenous content in every ship that we construct. From building the first Leander-class frigate way back in 1972, today the Indian Navy prides itself as one of the few navies in the world which has its own ship design capability that is ably supported by indigenous shipbuilding. A partnership with DRDO as well as with public and private enterprises have resulted in many successes in a number of fields, which include electronic warfare suits, communication systems, advanced underwater systems and sensors, combat management systems, radar, and metallurgy. We have been relentless in pursuing indigenization, and the Make in India remains an article of faith for the Indian Navy. Ladies and gentlemen, while we focus on indigenization, I must acknowledge the valuable contribution of our overseas partners. The OEM's continued support is indeed valuable to us. I am of the firm belief that self-reliance is the only mantra for strategic autonomy. Having said that, the path to self-reliance in defense needs to be charted meticulously in order to give further boost to our indigenous capability. The Indian Navy has outlined an indigenization plan which has been shared with the industry and is also available online. It is our endeavor to encourage both public and private sector to contribute towards progressively increasing the indigenous content in all future ships to as close as 200% as it can be under the Make in India. Indigenous development of high-end technology, their translation into defense hardware, induction into the service, and standardization is no mean task. It goes without saying that this process will require many challenges to be overcome, not only by designers and manufacturers, but also in the procurement process. I am pleased to note that the objective of ASSOCHAM conference this year is to provide simplification to the defense procurement process towards implementation of strategic partnership policy and bolstering Make in India. I'd like to take this opportunity to briefly outline the four primary expectations that we have with respect to platforms, systems, and equipment that we seek to induct. Firstly, the importance of completing development projects and delivering products in good time needs no explanation. Second factor is cost. After all, the factor of cost and delivery timelines would figure high to any customer. The third factor is quality and performance. The combatant must have unflinching faith that the equipment will deliver whenever the need arises to its design parameters. The fourth expectation is life cycle sustenance. Naval platforms and large platforms in the Army and the Air Force are expected to be in service for a considerable length of time. It is over this prolonged period that the weapons, sensors, and equipment fitted are expected to perform or rather outperform the enemy's capability. Therefore, it is critical to have a robust maintenance, repair, overall plan throughout its life cycle. Ladies and gentlemen, I am confident that this conference will provide a forum for discussion and exchange of ideas to strengthen Make in India in the defense sector. I wish everybody fruitful and positive deliberation. Shanno Varun, Jain, then thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, give a loud applause to the Chief of Naval Staff. I mean, ASSOCHAM is very fortunate that first time we have both the Chief of Naval Staff and Chief of Army Staff on our platform. I just wanted to intervene for a thing that we just want to highlight that, look, we have tried to bring niche technologies for war-winning weapons. Wars are won by weapons which are absolutely smart weapons. We have tried it through the DRDO, we have tried it through the OFB, we have tried it through the TOT route. We have been trying it for the last 40, 50 years. Our partner, knowledge partner, Dubey, gave out some comments, and we expected all of you, and we are very fortunate that both the chiefs have brought large number of senior officers, large number of users, those who are directly, for whom the industry has a quest to directly talk, to interact, for them to see their weapon systems. Niche technologies, foreign countries, or the foreign OEMs, there are very few foreign OEMs because they spend a lot of money on that, and they are the pride of their nations. It's very difficult to get those. First time in the last 3-4 years, you have unleashed the most dynamic weapon system which you have in India, and that is India's entrepreneur. You have large number of MSMEs being in defense for so long, having come out, seeing the defense industry, seeing the MSMEs, seeing the startups. You have a very, very rich knowledge people, people those who understand business, they have brought foreign partners here. Until unless they are encouraged, and since the Honorable Minister of State for Defense is here, I want to request, sir, until unless they are encouraged, this TOT will remain, believe you me, a dream for us, because it will always come in half-baked packages, which is very difficult to understand for engineers whom we hired about 50 years, 30 years, 20 years back. You need people, those who are young, those who have been hired by the industry, they understand it, they will take it further. You have all the global industries today in India present. So, but the leader has to be the Indian private industry. They do not display the type of muscle that is required in financial terms, in terms of industry, except the mother industries like the Tatas, the Reliance, the L&T, the Mahindras. But there are many here like MKUs, and I can keep naming them, those who are small, but they have stuck last 20 years. They've been with the user, they've been with you, they have been part of your dream. So I took that little time, and I thought it is better that since Dubey's point of view was taken very lightly, I thought it needs to be emphasized. And that's why Associam has been, we have done a tremendous service over the last 3 years. We've taken almost 40 MSMEs to Russia, to Moscow. We've invited all Moscow industry there. We have taken MSMEs to Israel. We've invited them there. Last year, 2016, we were very thankful, very fortunate to the defense minister. He gave us this opportunity. And we are very glad here that we have the CMD of HAL, we have the DRDO chief, we have the scientific advisor, we have a host of senior officers here. And once you come out and see the defense private industry, you'll find that our struggle in terms of finances, and if the foreign technology holder loses faith in your private industry also, you are a danger. You are a danger, because this is your last, what we call this, the last weapon that you've got. So thank you, sir. And now the lady will request you, this appeal was to you, that the private industry is looking up to you as the PSUs and as the OFP is looking at you.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pride and privilege to welcome Dr. Subhash Bhamre, the Honorable Raksha Rajya Mantri, Ministry of Defense, Government of India. Round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, as we request Dr. Subhash Bhamre to speak a few words for all of us.
I feel privileged to be here on the occasion of 9th ASCOM International Conference, Aerospace and Defense, bolstering Make in India in defense sector. Honorable Admiral Sunil Lamba, Chief of Naval Staff, General Bipin Rawat, Chief of Army Staff, dignitaries on dais, representatives of armed forces, representatives of global industries, ladies and gentlemen, friends from media, a very good morning to you all. The military capability of any nation rests on the cornerstone of self-reliance. And self-reliance in defense production has been goal of India's defense production strategy. And despite some silent achievement of our defense and aerospace production ecosystem, a significant part of our defense requirement continues to be dependent on import. A vibrant defense industry is a crucial component of effective defense capability, and to achieve national sovereignty and military superiority, government has, as a part of Make in India program, given a new impetus to development of defense production in the country, and several initiatives have been taken since then. The last 3 years, we have to promote a greater participation of industry as such. Defense procurement procedure has been revised in 2016. A new category of procurement by Indian IDDM, indigenously designed, developed, and manufactured, has been introduced in DPP 2016 to promote indigenously design and development. Government has notified the strategic partnership, which envisages the establishment of long-term strategic partnership with Indian entities. The MEC procedure has been simplified with provision for funding of 90% of development caused by the government to Indian industry and reserving project up to certain limits to MSMEs. Separate procedure for MEC 2 subcategory has been notified, wherein number of industry friendly provisions have been introduced. I welcome Honorable Raksha Mantri, Srimati Nirmala Ji Sitaraman.
Ladies and gentlemen, a huge, huge round of applause as we welcome Srimati Nirmala Sitaraman, the Honorable Raksha Mantri, Ministry of Defense, Government of India.
A separate procedure for MEC 2 subcategory has been notified, wherein number of industry-friendly provisions has been introduced. Defense investor cell has been created in the ministry to facilitate investors. FDI policy has been revised. FDI is allowed under automatic route up to 49% and beyond 49% through the government route, where it is likely to result in access to modern technology and other reasons to be recorded. The defense production list for the purpose of issuing industrial licenses has been pruned. Validity of the industrial license increased from 3 to 15 years. The process for export clearance has been streamlined and made transparent and online. Offset guidelines have been made flexible. Services as avenue of offset have been reinstated. Government has set up the Technology Development Fund to encourage the participation of public-private industries, especially MSMEs, through the provision of grants. In addition to above, the government plans to unveil the Defense Production Policy 2018 to further build on the above initiatives. The government has a series of further catalytic measures lined up for shaping up the requisite defense capabilities, namely competency mapping of the private defense industry, including MSMEs, listing out of platform weapon system being considered for the procurement in the next 10 years time frame by our services. Further liberalization of licensing and FDI regime, establishment of two defense industry corridor. I compliment the organizers. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us to release the knowledge paper jointly prepared by ASSOCHAM and KPMG. We request our chairman to kindly hand over the proud knowledge paper to Srimati Nirmala Sitaraman, the Honorable Raksha Mantri, Ministry of Defense, Government of India. Gives us warm pride and privilege as we welcome Thiru MC Sampath, the Honorable Minister for Industries, Government of Tamil Nadu. A round of applause as we welcome Thiru P. Benjamin, the Honorable Minister for Rural Industries, Government of Tamil Nadu. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, as we release the proud knowledge paper jointly prepared by ASSOCHAM and KPMG.
And we'll request you to kindly move out. Please kindly move out from there. All of you move out. Please move out. Please
move out. All of you to kindly cooperate with us.
Please move out from there. Please clear.
And now we request Sri Neeraj Gupta, the co-chairman from ASSOCHAM National Council on Aerospace and Defense, to speak a few words for all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause as we welcome Sri Neeraj Gupta to join us on stage, please.
Honorable Raksha Mantri Ji, Honorable Raksha Raj Mantri Ji, Chief of Indian Army General Rawat, Chief of Naval Staff Admiral Sudhin Lanba, Secretary Defense Production Sri Ajay Kumar Ji, distinguished dignitaries on the dais and off the dais. Ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to you all. For more than 20 years, I have been in the defense business. Never I have seen such a passion or dedication in any government towards making the domestic defense industry so vibrant and capable in the way the present government is approaching it. I feel both privileged and proud to witness this change. The thrust on Make in India and IDDM are the policies which will help in building defense manufacturing capability in India. However, history is testimony to the fact that self-reliance in defense manufacturing cannot be achieved only on domestic requirement. It is important to focus on exports for sustainable development. I would like to compliment our Honorable Raksha Mantri, Srimati Nirmala Sitaraman ji, and the Ministry of Defense for two extremely significant steps taken recently, which reaffirm the government's commitment to encouraging and facilitating exports. The release of the compendium on the Indian defense product and manufacturers and defense attachees conclave in Delhi 2 days back. This demonstrates the fact that MOD also understands the importance of exports for sustained growth of the Indian defense industry. While it is true that exports help build domestic capability, there are many other spin-off benefits also. I would like to briefly touch upon some of these. Manufacturing capability. In order to meet the global requirements and standards, such companies are focused to build large capabilities and manufacturing capacities. The objective of India's defense production policy will not be achieved without having a well thought out export strategy so that industry is assured of access to export market in addition of the domestic market. Technology acquisition and absorption. These companies are more exposed to the varied needs of their customers from different regions. Since the requirements are very customer specific and region specific, it gives them a wider exposure and pushes them to focus on R&D and technology upgradation to meet these challenges. Financial and economic sustainability. Defense business is unique and the only buyer is the government. Hence, the nature of business is cyclical with long gestation periods. This makes the industry vulnerable to the uncertainties of domestic procurement. Companies which also focus on exports are able to tide over this uncertainty since they handle requirements from a number of geographies. This ensures some continuity of orders and a sustained growth. However, there are some challenges also, which I would like to mention. I hope these are debated and discussed and given due consideration by the policymakers. Brand India should be carefully built and Government of India should aggressively promote it. India is still not perceived as a defense manufacturing nation. We have to consciously build Brand India by focusing on product quality, ensuring our global presence, international standard collaterals, ensuring our global presence, and continuous engagement by being there for the customer. Slowly, step by step, we will reach a position where countries will start to recognize India as a leading manufacturer of defense equipment. This will help Indian industry gain global acceptance. Many countries from Africa, Latin America, South Asia, and Middle East cannot afford to buy expensive defense equipment. They look to India to help build their defense capabilities. And we can provide them economical, technically competent equipment. The global majors understand this, and they are looking to Make in India to supplement their manufacturing bases. The government needs to aggressively pursue this. Extending line of credit for many countries in emerging markets could be another important factor in promoting exports. I am also thankful to DODP and particularly Dr. Ajay Kumar for further streamlining the process, and today we can get NOCs for exports within 2-3 weeks. However, I do feel the MOD should review the list of products in Appendix 2 and prune it further to include only lethal SCOMET items. Non-lethal items should be included in Appendix 1. Signing of logistical agreements wherever missing and leverage India's dominant position for G2G deals. This is another major step which can promote export of Indian defense equipment in a big way. It is heartening to note that MOD and SOCHM have kept one dedicated technical session on exports. I am sure the deliberations in this session will dwell upon some of the important issues which will benefit all stakeholders. SOCHM is also taking a delegation to Eurosatory, and I would like to invite all my Indian industry friends to come and participate in the Eurosatory exhibition as much as possible. In the end, I appeal to all, let us rise to the challenge and seize this opportunity to place the Indian defense industry on the global scene. Let us put our best foot forward to ensure that together we achieve exports of $5 billion from India by 2025 as envisaged in the proposed draft defense production policy. Thank you. Jai Hind.
It gives me great honor and privilege as we welcome Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman, the Honorable Raksha Mantri, Ministry of Defense, Government of India, to speak a few words for all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, a huge, huge round of applause as we welcome Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman on stage, please. A very warm welcome, ma'am.
Good afternoon. I suddenly felt too much at home. Not because I'm in Tamil Nadu, but because I have so many officers in front of me, I thought I was in MOD. Is this a SOCHAM's meeting? I can see the members at the back, but it's good. It gives a certain sense of confidence and sense of being assured when my own people are in front. Thank you very much. I'm indeed very grateful to ASSOCHAM for initiating in this environment a detailed discussion on what actually the defense production and defense production policy is going to mean in the context of Prime Minister's Make in India and in the context of Prime Minister's focus for making defense production not just for India but for also export. So I think industry association coming forward to have a discussion with all the stakeholders and to invite various interest groups to be together while addressing that issue, and for that to have a document like this prepared which goes into the detail of how do you create a level playing field is just going to help us think better, be more focused, and come up with specifics with which government can facilitate this whole initiative of wanting India to become a defense manufacturing hub. I'm very glad to see officers from all the three forces actively engaging with industry, understanding and sharing their thoughts in the process. It is really high time that Indian industry, which has reached quite some heights in very many difficult areas, technologically proven themselves, and in terms of achieving global standards, whichever industry be it, engineering, textiles, pharmaceuticals, you can name it all. If they are doing it, and if engineering, and we are sitting in an automobile hub, if in engineering and in automobiles, we've already proven that we've reached such standards globally, that there are times when we are told from people that globally, wherever there is a car, there is a product or a component which has gone from India. Should we just stop at that? Should we just stop at automobile? Should we just stop at making components and not the main platforms themselves? So I think time is up now. It's high time that we from the industry and government sit together, work together, and make sure that that which we can do, we should do. And that which we can do in the, for the future, we should be able to plan up now, because here is a government which is wanting to hear from you, understand, and also facilitate for you, so that that which is otherwise growing immensely within a certain domain within the government, only because all this while we thought it is a prerogative of the government and the private sector shouldn't come in, like the way ISRO, for instance, has reached pinnacles, is able to do what any other country would do in a budget which is 10 times more than what we can do in ISRO. So both from the cost effectiveness, from the way in which technology can be mastered and keep abreast of technological development, ISRO has stood out for India. But I'm sure there are many more such institutions, even within the DRDO, about whom I raise a lot of questions every now and then. It is possible for us to cull out every such, let's say, vertical, and in those verticals with infusion of private participation, we should be able to come out with tech-savvy, high-tech, and frontier technology-related manufacturing in which the government can, from the point of view of policy, make it easy. From the point of view of regulation, make it easy. From the point of view of buying and contracting newer customers from abroad, make it easy. So the government can play a very, very important and effective catalyst. But of course, it's for those research and development organizations within the government and also for those in private sector to come together to make sure that that is achievable. And we don't need too many years for it. I think we've spent a lot of time in India working and working, but very much inward. Now it's the time for us to open up and look outwards, both for the market and also for technologies which you might want for that critical difference. So without saying much more, I appreciate the ASSOS CHAM for taking this opportunity, and no better environment than a Defence Expo to talk about it and to bring together people both from the government and from the private sector to work together on this objective. I wish you all very well, and thank you very much for having initiated this report. It's going to be of great help for us. Thank you.
We now request Dr. S.C. Kansal, the chairman from SM Group, to conclude the remarks and deliver the vote of thanks for all of us.
Yeah, very good morning to everybody. Well, I have been asked to give a concluding remarks and vote of thanks. Well, in concluding remarks, you know, I got something by which my all friends have told. What could be done by the industry? And what would be done by the government? So there's a big gap, which gap is filled up by the Make in India policy of the government. With this, I will end up with my vote of thanks later. Now to address Honorable Raksha Mantri Shrimati Nirmala Sitharam ji, Honorable Raja Raksha Mantri Dr. Subhash Bhamre ji, Chairman of Chiefs of Staff Admiral Sunil Lamba ji, Chief of Army Staff General Vipin Rawat ji, Secretary Defence Production Dr. Ajay Kumar ji, VIP.
பொதிகை சமூகத்தின் மகிழ்ச்சி 701 அரங்கங்கள், 539 இந்திய அரங்கங்கள், 162 வெளிநாட்டு அரங்கங்கள். டெஃப் எக்ஸ்போ 18. ஏப்ரல் 12 தேதி காலை 9:30 மணி முதல் நமது பொதிகையில் நேரடி ஒளிபரப்பு, காண தவறாதீர்கள். பொதிகை சமூகத்தின் மகிழ்ச்சி.
நேயர்களே, சென்னை அருகே இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தையில் பத்தாவது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ, அதாவது ராணுவ கண்காட்சி என்று அழைக்கப்படும் பத்தாவது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போவை முன்னிட்டு நம் ராணுவ அதிகாரிகள் மட்டுமல்லாமல் இந்தியாவின் பாதுகாப்புத்துறை அமைச்சர் திருமதி நிர்மலா சீதாராமன் அவர்கள் டிஃபென்ஸ் சம்பந்தப்பட்ட ஒரு புத்தகத்தையும் வெளியிட்டு இந்த கண்காட்சியில் நம் மக்களுக்காக என்னென்ன விஷயங்கள் காத்துக்கொண்டிருக்கிறது அப்படிங்கறத ரொம்ப சிறப்பா நம் ஊடக நண்பர்கள் கிட்ட பகிர்ந்து கொண்ட அந்த அற்புதமான சந்திப்பை நம்ம எல்லாருமே பார்த்தோம். டிஃபென்ஸ், அதாவது ராணுவம் நம் நாட்டுக்கு முக்கியமான ஒரு விஷயம். அதுவும் இப்ப இருக்கக்கூடிய காலகட்டத்துல டிஃபென்ஸ் வந்து ஒரு முக்கியமான கண், முக்கியமான தூண் அப்படின்னு கூட சொல்லலாம். அதுவும் நம்ம ராணுவ வீரர்கள் மட்டுமல்லாமல் கடற்படை வீரர்களா இருக்கட்டும், விமானப்படை வீரர்களா இருக்கட்டும், நம் நாட்டுடைய பாதுகாப்புக்காக ஓயாம உழைக்கிறாங்க. இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போவை முன்னிட்டு ஏப்ரல் 11ஆம் தேதியிலிருந்து ஆரம்பிச்சு ஏப்ரல் 14ஆம் தேதி வரைக்கும் வெவ்வேறு விதமான சாகசங்களை அவர்கள் அனைவரும் சேர்ந்து நிகழ்த்த இருக்கிறார்கள். இன்று முதல் நாள், அதாவது முதல் நாள் ஏற்கனவே நான் சொன்ன மாதிரி இந்தியா மட்டுமல்லாமல் அமெரிக்கா, ரஷ்யா, ஜப்பான், பிரிட்டன் போன்ற 47 நாடுகள் சேர்ந்து இந்த அற்புதமான பிரம்மாண்டமான ராணுவ கண்காட்சியில் பல விதமான சாகசங்களை நிகழ்த்த இருக்கிறார்கள். சாகசங்கள் மட்டும் இல்லைங்க, நம்மளுடைய இந்தியா ரஷ்யா ராணுவ நிறுவனங்களுடைய கருத்தரங்கமும் நம்ம வந்து பார்த்து ரசிக்க இருக்கிறோம். அதாவது நான் ஏற்கனவே சொன்ன மாதிரி இப்படிப்பட்ட இந்த வீரர்களுடைய அந்த சாகசங்கள்லாம் பார்க்கும்போது நம் நாட்டுடைய பாதுகாப்புக்காக அவங்க எல்லாருமே வந்து எந்த அளவுக்கு பாடுபடுறாங்க அப்படிங்கிறத நம்மளால உணர முடியும். அதாவது நாளை ஏப்ரல் 12ஆம் தேதி இந்தியாவின் பிரதம மந்திரி திரு நரேந்திர மோடி அவர்கள் வருகை தந்து இந்த 10th டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போவை பார்வையிட்டு நம்மளுடைய வீரர்கள் நிகழ்த்தக்கூடிய அந்த சாகசங்களையும் கண்டு ரசிக்க இருக்கிறார். ஏப்ரல் 14ஆம் தேதி நம் எல்லோருக்கும் சந்தோஷமான ஒரு நாள். அதாவது இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போல இருக்கக்கூடிய இந்த சாகசங்கள் எல்லாத்தையுமே நம்ம பார்த்து ரசிக்கணும் அப்படிங்கிற ஆசை நம்ம எல்லாருக்குமே இருக்குங்க. அதுவும் நமக்கு மட்டுமல்லாமல் நமக்கு அடுத்தபடியாக இருக்கக்கூடிய சந்ததிகளும் இப்படிப்பட்ட இந்த அரிய காட்சியை, இப்படிப்பட்ட இந்த பிரம்மாண்டமான காட்சியை நேரலையாக பார்க்கும் போது அவர்களுக்கு அந்த உணர்வு இன்னமும் கொஞ்சம் அதிகமாகவே இருக்கும். ஏப்ரல் 14ஆம் தேதி 10ஆவது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ, அதாவது சென்னை அருகே இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தையில் நடந்து கொண்டே இருக்கும் இந்த 10ஆவது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போல இருக்கக்கூடிய அனைத்து சாகசங்களையும் நம்மளும் போய் கண்டு ரசிக்கலாம். ஏப்ரல் 14ஆம் தேதி இந்த சாகசங்களை நம்ம எல்லாருமே கண்டு ரசிக்கணும்னா ஆதார் அட்டை அல்லது அரசு அங்கீகரிக்கப்பட்ட அடையாள அட்டை ஒன்றை நம்ம எடுத்துக்கொண்டு நேரலையாக செல்லலாம். மொபைல் போன்ஸ் எல்லாமே வந்து அலவுட், ஸோ அதனால நம்மளுடைய மொபைல்ல இந்த அரிய காட்சிகளை நம்ம பதிவு செய்து எப்போ வேணாலும் பார்க்கலாம். அதாவது எப்போ பார்த்தாலும் ரொம்ப நம் கண்களுக்கு இருக்கக்கூடிய ஒரு அற்புதமான விருந்து இப்படிப்பட்ட காட்சிகள். அதாவது நம்ம ராணுவ வீரர்கள் மட்டுமல்லங்க, விமானப்படை வீரர்களா இருக்கட்டும் இல்ல கடற்படை வீரர்களா இருக்கட்டும், அவர்கள் ஒவ்வொரு சாகசங்களையும் நிகழ்த்துறதுக்கு எப்படி எல்லாம் வந்து ட்ரைனிங் எடுக்கிறாங்க, எப்படி எல்லாம் பிராக்டிஸ் பண்றாங்க, ரொம்ப ஒரு அயலாத கடுமையான முயற்சிக்கு பின்னலாம் இப்படிப்பட்ட அற்புதமான சாகசங்கள் வந்து நிகழ்த்தி கொண்டிருக்கிறார். சோ இந்த 10ஆவது டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ, அதாவது இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ 10ஆவது முறையாக இந்த வருடம் சென்னை அருகே இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தையில் இன்று நம்ம வந்து ஆரம்பிச்சிருக்கோம். அதாவது இந்திய பாதுகாப்புத்துறை அமைச்சர் திருமதி நிர்மலா சீதாராமன் அவர்கள் இந்த சந்திப்புல நம்ம எல்லாருமே பார்த்திருப்போம், ராணுவ சம்பந்தப்பட்ட ஒரு புத்தகத்தையும் வெளியிட்டு ராணுவம் எந்த அளவுக்கு நம்ம நாட்டுக்கு வந்து முக்கியமான ஒரு விஷயம் அப்படிங்கறதையும் தன்னுடைய பேச்சுக்கள் மூலமாக நம் ஊடக நண்பர்கள் கிட்ட அவங்க பகிர்ந்துகிட்டாங்க. சோ இன்று நம்ம ராணுவ வீரர்கள் மட்டுமல்லாமல் விமானப்படை வீரர்களுடைய சாகசங்களையும் நேரலையாக நாம் பார்க்க இருக்கிறோம். நாளை பாத்தீங்கன்னா திரு நரேந்திர மோடி அவர்கள் வருகை தந்து இந்த சாகசங்கள்ல இருக்கக்கூடிய அற்புதமான விஷயங்களை நேரலையாக பார்வையிட்டு நம்ம ராணுவ வீரர்களுக்கு ஒரு ஊக்கம் தரும் விதத்திலையும் வந்து பல சாகசங்களை நேரலையாக பார்க்க இருக்கிறார். அது மட்டுமல்லாமல் ஏப்ரல் 14ஆம் தேதி முக்கியமான ஒரு நாள், நம்ம எல்லாருமே சென்னை அருகே இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தைக்கு போயிட்டு ஆதார் அட்டை அல்லது அரசு அங்கீகரிக்கப்பட்ட ஏதாவது ஒரு அடையாள அட்டையை நேரலையாக எடுத்து சென்று இந்த சாகசங்களை நம்மளும் பார்க்கறதுக்கான ஒரு அரிய வாய்ப்பு நமக்காக கொடுத்திருக்காங்க. இன்னும் நிறைய விஷயங்கள் நான் சொல்ல போறேன், நீங்க பார்க்க இருக்கீங்க, அவங்களுடைய சாகசங்களையும் பார்க்க போறீங்க. ஆனா அதுக்கு முன்னால இப்ப உங்கள் அனைவருக்கும் வர இருப்பது ஒரு இடைவேளை.
பொதிகை, சமூகத்தின் மகிழ்ச்சி. 701 அரங்கங்கள், 539 இந்திய அரங்கங்கள், 162 வெளிநாட்டு அரங்கங்கள். டெஃப் எக்ஸ்போ 18. ஏப்ரல் 12ஆம் தேதி காலை 9:30 மணி முதல் நமது பொதிகையில் நேரடி ஒளிபரப்பு, காண தவறாதீர்கள். பொதிகை, சமூகத்தின் மகிழ்ச்சி.
சென்னை அருகே இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தையில் 10th டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ ரொம்ப பிரம்மாண்டமான முறையில இன்னைக்கு ஆரம்பிச்சு வச்சிருக்காங்க. அதாவது ராணுவ அதிகாரிகள் மட்டுமல்லாமல் இந்தியாவின் பாதுகாப்புத்துறை அமைச்சர் திருமதி நிர்மலா சீதாராமன் அவர்களும் வந்து டிஃபென்ஸ் சம்பந்தப்பட்ட ஒரு புத்தகத்தையும் வெளியிட்டு இந்த 4 நாட்கள் என்னென்ன விஷயங்கள்லாம் நடக்க இருக்கிறது அப்படிங்கறத நம்ம ஊடக நண்பர்கள் கிட்ட ரொம்ப அற்புதமா பகிர்ந்து கொண்டார்கள். சரி, இப்ப உங்க எல்லாருக்குமே இன்னொரு சந்தோஷமான விஷயம், அதாவது நம்ம வந்து பள்ளிக்கூடம் படிக்கும் போதும் சரி இல்ல கல்லூரி படிக்கும் போதும் சரி இந்த போர் கப்பலை பத்தி வந்து நிறைய விஷயங்கள் நம்ம படிச்சிருக்கோம். சோ அப்படிப்பட்ட இந்த ஒரு போர் கப்பலை கூட நேரலையா பாக்கிறதுக்கான ஒரு வாய்ப்பு நமக்கு இருக்கு. அதுக்கு என்ன பண்ணணும்னா ஐலண்ட் கிரவுண்ட்ல போய் நீங்க ஒரு ரெஜிஸ்ட்ரேஷன் மட்டும் பண்ணிக்கிட்டீங்கன்னா போர் கப்பலை நேரலையா நம்ம பார்த்து பார்க்கலாம். இப்பொழுது சென்னை அருகே இருக்கக்கூடிய திருவிடந்தையில் நடந்து கொண்டிருக்கும் 10th டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போவில் பத்திரிகை தொலைக்காட்சி நண்பர்களை சந்தித்து இந்தியாவின் பாதுகாப்புத்துறை அமைச்சர் திருமதி நிர்மலா சீதாராமன் அவர்கள் சில முக்கியமான விஷயங்களை பகிர்ந்து கொள்ள போகிறார். அதை நாம் நேரலையாக பார்ப்போம்.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Kindly be seated. Kindly settle down. We are in a few moments. We are going to start the press conference by RM. May I request the photographers to kindly click the photos a bit later. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly settle down. Kindly settle down quickly.
अच्छा मैडम को
Dignitaries all have come.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I, on behalf of the Honorable Raksha Mantri, Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman, Department of Defense Production, Ministry of Defense, and Directorate of Public Relations, Ministry of Defense, I will welcome all of you to this press conference. Today, in our midst, we have Honorable Raksha Mantri. To her right is Honorable Raksha Mantri Dr. Subhash Bhamre. To her left is Defense Secretary Shri Sanjay Mitra. To her extreme left is Secretary Defense Production, Dr. Ajay Kumar, and to her extreme right is the Chairman, DRDO, Dr. S. Christopher. On behalf of the Directorate of Public Relations, Ministry of Defense, I welcome all the dignitaries on the dais by presenting a bouquet. First, I would request the Honorable RM to accept the bouquet. Madam. I would request the Defense Secretary to accept the bouquet. I would request the RM. Okay, I would request the Secretary of Defense Production to accept the bouquet, please. And lastly, I would request, that's right. I would request the Chairman DRDO to accept the bouquet. And I would So now I request the Honorable RM to please give her the opening remarks followed by the media interaction. Please, ma'am.
Good afternoon and thank you for your presence here. I hope it's audible. I get the feeling the AC is a bit noisy. I'm very grateful that all of you all have found time to be here. This is once in 2 years that Government of India Ministry of Defense holds the Defense Expo. The details of the participation and the delegations which have come will all be given to you in detail. But I value this media interaction which is happening on the first day of this Defense Expo. We are getting on with the business and business-to-business interactions and also engaging with the various delegations from today. However, the formal inauguration of this Defense Expo is going to be only tomorrow, and we are fortunate to have the Honorable Prime Minister come for the inauguration and also to be a witness to all the demonstration which is going to happen. All the three services will be presenting their little display of what they can do. And for the first time, this time's Defense Expo has two distinct features which I want to draw your attention to. India, as you know, is a major importer of defense equipments. We've always had this Defense Expo as a way in which we invited major manufacturers of weapon systems, manufacturers of war equipments, and also all those who produce major defense-related items to showcase their products. And every 2 years, we had this assembly of public sector undertakings and others to also showcase what they do, post which you had a lot of contracts signed between businesses and between government and businesses and so on. That will continue even this year. But this year you will have, in addition, a very clear accent on India as a manufacturer and seller of defense equipment. India as a manufacturer, and not just selling to India, but with a potential to export. Also, many of them who are already exporting their wares as defense manufacturers. And in that, we have given a very big play for the small and medium private sector units. And they shall also be given a concessional presence here so that they get this at least apparent level playing field with the big producers, with which they will be able to equally display what they produce, which are relevant for the defense procurers. If this is the larger picture with which this Defense Expo has been brought in, I would like to take a minute to have a special mention that institutions like the DRDO, the HAL, the Bharat Electronics Limited, and so on, several of them, who have been over the decades doing extraordinary R&D related work and coming up with a lot of products, which within India, certainly we know, we recognize, and we also give them a lot of opportunities. But under DRDO, that there are about 50 different institutions, all of which are engaged in defense research, and all of whom, at least each one of whom, have at least a few patents to their credit. And they're also commercially viable products to be displayed and showcased, is something which we have highlighted in this Defense Expo. So if there are people who feel, all right, today you want the private sector to display, but what is it? Earlier we had only one DRDO stall, now you have 10 of them taking it. Is it to just fill space? What a shame. What a shame for anyone to have to think in those lines. DRDO has institutions which are working under it, which have particular specializations, which also have products which have to be displayed. And this Defense Expo, we have taken extreme pride to give them each an opportunity to come out and display the products. And therefore, more of DSDO. Therefore, certainly more of DRDO. Certainly more of HAL. Certainly more of BEL and so on. So if we in India are not able to give them the space, give each of them the space, I'm not sure if with the, given the budget and the constraints that you may have, they can go in search of every defense expo anywhere else outside. So it is a conscious decision. It's a decision where we wanted to promote our institutions, and therefore we've given them the space. I'm happy the Secretary DRDO is here. I've just had a word with him about it also. So without extending my initial remarks, I'm glad that the Defense Secretary is here. I'm glad that the Raksha Rajya Mantri is here. I'm also very glad that DRDO Secretary and the Defense Production Secretary is here. The three chiefs are also in this premises. So it's a great opportunity for all of us to interact with one another and make the best out of Defense Expo. And one last point, Defense Expo this time being held here is being held with a very clear purpose, that if in the budget two defense production corridors were announced, one of which is located in Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, because we wanted to capitalize on, leverage on the OFBs, the public sector undertakings, and a wonderful combination of private sector, which is already coming at the tier one level, tier two level, and many small units which are spread all over these the entire quad area that we've marked. So to, in order to benefit, in order to give the synergy, in order to be able to benefit mutually, the budgetary announcement of the corridor being here, and the fact that in South India, the defense expo has never come down. We've always been so Delhi-centric. I'm grateful that Manohar Parikar, my senior predecessor in this ministry, took it over to Goa. Now, because the Prime Minister has been saying repeatedly, out of Delhi, go to all parts of the country, we've chosen to come here. And therefore, this is the best opportunity for Tamil Nadu to be able to cash on it, and also many other industries which can come and benefit from here. One last point, you're actually sitting in a historically important coast. This specific area, with Mahabalipuram on one side, and also a modern village which has come up to recreating the village life in all the southern states, Telangana, Andhra, Kerala, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu, all in one place in Cholamandalam. You are sitting in a tourist hotspot. You are sitting in a historically important place from where huge ships of the Chola kingdom had gone to the entire Southeast Asia. And from here did we have our culture, commerce, and our navy prowess shown towards entire Southeast Asia. So if today we are talking of Indian Ocean region, if you're talking of Indian Ocean region becoming India Pacific, they were all achieved by the Cholas of here already. We are only going to have to strengthen that step. And therefore this place was chosen for very many reasons. Very many reasons, all of which deserve equally to be played up. I would request all of you all also in this context to take a few minutes out of your busy schedule here and visit Mahabalipuram, visit Cholamandalam, get the feel of this beautiful East Coast, which you can see from here itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Now we invite questions from the media friends. Kindly raise your hands. Our young volunteers will get the mics to you. Then only you speak, otherwise recording would be a problem. Yeah, can you give it here to Ajay Banerjee? Just coming. One question each, please.
Hi, ma'am, to your right. Ma'am, this way, to your right. Ma'am, I'm Ajay Banerjee from the Tribune. Ma'am, I have two small points to ask. First, what is the status of the defense production policy? And does the SP model, the supposed amendment, will include DPSUs to be partners of foreign OEMs?
As regards the defense production policy, the draft has been released for public consultation. We have received over 100 comments from various stakeholders, from industry, from professional groups, from academia, from individuals, and we are in process of examining those comments. And based on that, and based on consultations with other ministries, because there are several ministries concerned, the policy will be placed for approval of government, and we hope to see the final policy very soon. The consultation process is on, and then we should be able to do it as soon as possible.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, over here.
Insofar as the strategic partnership is concerned, we as you are aware, that the DPSUs are even now are eligible to enter into strategic partnerships with foreign OEMs. Yeah, this is in response to the questions regarding strategic partnership. These are still early days, we are working on it, and we will take a view on whether or not and to what extent DPSUs will be involved at an appropriate time. We are still at the RFI stage and still early days.
Yeah. Can you please ask?
Ma'am.
Please wait, one after the other. We are coming to you.
Just a few days ago, ma'am, the intelligence reports have spoken about the JEM particularly and other terror organizations not just targeting Kashmir, but several other areas in India. They want a wider playing field. And some of them include spots like Ayodhya. Now, you're part of the CCS. Have certain precautions been taken to ensure these attacks, if they happen, are foiled? Secondly, ma'am, this Colonel Ravindranath was a hero of the Kargil War. He was awarded a gallantry award. And yet, yesterday, the Karnataka state government sort of neglected in giving him state honors. Can the center and the defense ministry do something about it now, at least so that in future this does not happen?
I'm glad you brought this up. We'll certainly do everything it takes to honor a war hero. I'm not going to get into the details of who did and who didn't. We'll certainly do it. And as regards keeping the country safe and your first question related to what is it that you're doing, being a part of the CCS, I'm sure all of us are equally concerned, and we shall be constantly monitoring and taking all necessary steps. Although I won't be in a position to say openly in a media as to what are those. We are seized of the matter though.
Manish?
Ma'am, this side. This is Manas from PTI, I'm Press Trust of India. Ma'am, the Defence Expo has been billed as, in fact, a starting point for making India the defence manufacturing hub. So, ma'am, what are the specific outcomes that you are looking at from Defence Expo? And the second point is that the strategic partnership model was announced in May last year. And since then, actually, critics say that nothing concrete has been achieved and we are yet to roll out the strategic partnership model. So, ma'am, in fact, when can we expect the first project under the strategic partnership model? Thank you so much.
As regards Def Expo, this is, as the Honorable Minister has said, one of the main outcomes that we are trying to achieve is to project India as a new emerging manufacturing hub for defense systems. And we have in this India Pavilion, which is a combined effort of public sector and private sector, defense companies in India, MSMEs in India, startups in India, who are in this field, and their best is being projected. I would invite all of you to go and visit. We are also showcasing a live demonstration of naval, aero, and land systems, all of which are manufactured in India. More specifically, during this expo, as you would see over the next 4 days, several joint agreements, collaborations, business-to-business agreements have been planned. It would not be fair on my part. It is those prerogative of those companies to make announcements about them. But I am aware that several companies have lined up. They are in process of discussing and going to be announcing major agreements for collaboration. I am also, DRDO has planned several transfer of technology agreements with various companies, and that seminar is actually scheduled today afternoon, and I would like to invite. So all around, this Defence Expo is going to create a great collaborative environment for Indian companies as well as foreign companies who are there to do business in India. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Insofar as the
good
question,
afternoon. First, she'll okay.
To respond to your question about strategic partnership, I am happy to inform you that the first RFI under strategic partnership has been rolled out a couple of days ago. So we are getting there. I mean, and it's very difficult to give a deadline as to when a project will materialize. This is just the first step. These are very long-term issues involving foreign investors and transfer of technology. The first step has been taken, RFI has been uploaded. We are going ahead. We are in business.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Aarti from Pudiya Talamurai. Keep the mic closer. Aarti from Pudiya Talamurai. Rendu questions iruka. Onnu vandu indha Ranuva Thalavada Maiyangal. Mic.
ராணுவ தளவாட மையங்கள் அமைப்பதற்காக உற்பத்தியாளர்கள் கருத்தரங்கம் வந்து நடைபெற்றது. அந்த உற்பத்தியாளர்கள் தற்பொழுது எந்த அளவுக்கு ஆர்வம் காட்டிட்டு வர்றாங்க, அதற்கான பணிகள் வந்து எந்த அளவுக்கு போயிட்டு இருக்கு? திஸ் இஸ் மை ஃபர்ஸ்ட் க்வெஸ்சன். அண்ட் ரெண்டாவது வந்து சென்னையை வந்து மிகப்பெரிய நேவல் பேஸா மாத்துறதுக்கான பணிகள் வந்து நடைபெற்று வருகிறதா? அப்படி மிகப்பெரிய நேவல் பேஸா மாத்துறதுக்கான காரணம் என்ன?
ப்ளீஸ் வெயிட்.
Actually,
நீங்க கேட்டதுக்கு தமிழ்ல நான் சொல்ல ட்ரை பண்றேன். As far as the ப்ரொடக்ஷனுக்கு நிறைய இண்டஸ்ட்ரி.
Okay, the question, you want to translate the question please for
what I was asked is that whether the support from the industry is there for the production in the country. I strongly believe the corridors where we have aimed at need to be nurtured, and there is a lot of interest shown by the country, the various industries. As a matter of fact, we have got about 750 TOTs already signed. Even this afternoon we have lined up about 10 TOTs, some of them from very much from Tamil Nadu itself. So the support is certainly there. As regards the larger air, I mean naval base in Chennai, I think the right person to answer is would be madam.
Please.
You know, when this Def Expo was started, we had we wanted to project India as a manufacturing base. We had initially said at least 50% of the exhibitors should be Indian companies. Today, more than 75% companies have come, and we had to stop registration because there was no space left in the ground. That is the response we have received. We have done different interaction with industry in 5 cities in Tamil Nadu itself, in Chennai, in Hosur, in Coimbatore, in Trichinopoly, and in Salem. And each of these, we have several hundreds of industries who have come forward. I think Tamil Nadu, with its tremendous base, has huge potential to develop into a great defense manufacturing hub, and so is the case with several other states in areas in the country.
Yeah, next question.
Hi, Monica Arora from Vayu.
Naval bases.
அதுக்கு இப்போதைக்கு இதுதான் சொல்ல முடியும், அதனால தான் அந்த க்வெஸ்சனுக்கு மாறிட்டோம்.
ஹாய், மோனிகா ரோரா ஃப்ரம் வாயு. மை க்வெஸ்சன் இஸ் தட் த நியூ ஆர்எஃப்ஐ ஃபார் நியூ ஃபைட்டர்ஸ் ஹஸ் ஜஸ்ட் பின் இஷூட். இஸ் திஸ் அ ரீரன் ஆஃப் தி அபார்டட் எம்எம்ஆர்சிஏ ப்ரோக்ராம்?
The chief of air staff is in this is present here. I think it's a question best addressed to him. I don't think there are we need to have any such apprehension. This is a fresh RFI designed for fresh purposes, and look at it like that.
Ma'am, main Sanjay Singh hu, Rashtriya Sahara, Delhi se. Sabse pehle to main aapko badhai deta hu is shandar aayojan ke liye. Mera sawal ye hai ki aapne bola tha parson ki hamari misailon mein dusre deshon ne ruchi dikhai hai. तो ये कौन कौन से देश हैं और क्या इस डेफ एक्सपो में कोई डील होने की संभावना है? थैंक यू.
मैं अगर बोल पाऊंगी तो उसी दिन बोलते. देश का नाम तो इतना खुलेआम बोल नहीं सकती हूं उस विषय में. द क्वेश्चन दैट वाज आस्क्ड वाज अ फ्यू डेज अगो आई हैड मेंशनड दैट देयर इज अ लॉट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट ऑन इंडियन मिसाइल्स इन कंट्रीज अब्रॉड एंड वी आर एंगेजिंग विद देम. அதாவது இந்தியாவில் உற்பத்தியாகக்கூடிய மிசைல்ஸ் ஏவுகணைகளுக்கு நிறையா வெளிநாட்டில் இன்ட்ரெஸ்ட் இருக்கு, அவங்க விரும்புகிறாங்க அப்படின்னு நான் 4 நாளுக்கு முன்னாடி சொல்லியிருந்தேன். இங்கே அது எந்தெந்த நாடுகளில் அந்த மாதிரி இன்ட்ரெஸ்ட் இருக்குன்னு நீங்கள் சொல்ல முடியுமான்னு கேட்குறாரு. நான் அந்த நாடுகளோட பேர் எடுக்க முடிஞ்சால் அன்றைக்கே எடுத்து சொல்லியிருந்திருப்பேன். பப்ளிக்கில் எடுக்கக்கூடிய விஷயம் இல்லை, வெளிநாடுகள்னு அதுக்கு தான் பொதுவாக சொல்லியிருந்தேன். இசிலே மேனே தோ ஜென்ரலி போலா कि बहुत विदेश में इसके ऊपर रुचि है, आप सही कह रहे हैं, मगर खुलेआम उनके नाम में बोल नहीं पाऊंगी, क्षमा कीजिए।
यस मैम, आई एम गजाला वहाब फ्रॉम फोर्स मैगजीन। माय क्वेश्चन इज, वेयर विल द नेक्स्ट डेफ एक्सपो बी हेल्ड? विल चेन्नई बी अ परमानेंट लोकेशन और विल इट शिफ्ट टू द नेक्स्ट डिफेंस इंडस्ट्रियल कॉरिडोर?
I have next to me Raksha Rajya Mantri, who hails from Maharashtra. I'm sure he will also be planning that he should have it in Maharashtra. I don't think any of us go on the basis of I belong to a state, I should go there. If that's the case, I should also think of being, because I'm an MP from Karnataka, I should hold it in Karnataka. And I wouldn't mind holding it in Karnataka. Karnataka unfortunately has elections going on now. Elections are on in Karnataka. So I'm not sure our decision making is based on I belong to a state, I have to go there. If that's the case, I should be looking after Andhra Pradesh, I should be looking after Karnataka and also Tamil Nadu and so on. No, I think the larger interest of where is it possible to have one of the best exhibitions done and what are the other factors which will go into it and so on. So whichever state fits the bill for that, we'll go there.
Madam?
Well, on the question of having a permanent location for Defence Expo, nothing has been thought out as yet.
Madam?
Snehish?
Yeah. Ma'am Snehish here from Republic TV. Ma'am Snehish here from Republic TV. You mentioned that...
Mike, please.
Yeah, the Secretary mentioned that the first RFI under the strategic partnership has been rolled out. So how is it different from the MMRCA contract, and would all fighters undergo the same set of trials all over again? Hello. Yeah. So how different is the current RFI from the MMRCA, and would all aircraft undergo the same set of trials, because some have already undergone trial earlier? And the second question is to the DRDO chief. The QRSAM was tested on Monday. What has been the status of that missile test?
Yeah, it is a trial testing. We have met parameters, whatever we're looking for, partially. We have not completed it. We have yet to go through that. Much more experiments are to be conducted.
Madam, Manakam.
On the question of, again, the RFI and MMRC RFI, why don't you go through it and take a look? And if you have specific questions on what you want me to address, on how is it different or not different, I am open to answers.
Madam, Manakam, Madam, Jaikumar Raj TV. ஜெயக்குமார் ராஜ் டிவி, அதாவது பிரதமர் நாளைக்கு வந்து கண்காட்சி தொடங்கி வைக்கிறான்னு சொல்லியிருந்தீங்க, அந்த கண்காட்சி ஷெட்யூல் ஏதாவது டைம் சேஞ்ச் இருக்கா மேடம்? அதாவது நீங்க ஏற்கனவே அறிவிச்ச ஷெட்யூல் இருக்கா மேடம்?
எனக்கு தெரிஞ்ச ஷெட்யூல்ல டைமிங்ல மாறுதல் ஒண்ணுமே இல்லை.
அஜய்
மேம், திஸ் சைட் மேடம், ஐ அம் அஜய் சுக்லா ஃப்ரம் பிசினஸ் ஸ்டாண்டர்ட். It was mentioned that we've got a special exhibit of made in India weapon systems that are being displayed on DEF Expo, and you're hoping that that will increase imports and draw attention to our defense capabilities. But as everybody knows, us including you, a serious problem is our own military's unwillingness to accept it made in India weapon platforms. The Arjun tank, the LCA, the Akash, they've all been inducted in very limited quantities, unlikely to make a global splash. Is there any steps that you have or any measures that you're taking, and if so, what, to prevail upon our own military to start using made in India systems?
While I understand from where you're asking this question, and it certainly will seem logical that when you're trying to export some things, it should be first be used by your own forces. They do, and maybe they can do even more. But when I'm promoting Indian exports, Indian manufacturing, I'm also telling the forces to, as much as possible, procure from them. They do too, but I will want to draw a thin line, and I'm conscious it's a thin line, between, one, my in the sense the government's enthusiasm to make sure the production capabilities are such that they can meet with international standards and be export worthy, and the other side of the line where
army or navy or air force make their decision on what they want, what combination of equipments they want, and in that combination, if an Indian produced item fits in well, they take it, take as much as they require of it. But I can't for a moment imagine that I'll prevail upon them to necessarily buy what is Indian, which I'm also wanting to export, much against certain other requirements which they may want to look at. So in order to keep them fit, prepared, and absolutely lean and mean, it is their final call that I have to respect. Whilst I want to have many more Indian-produced, Indian-designed, Indian-manufactured equipments or missiles or any other platforms, I would want to say they are doing it, but maybe not as much as you and I would want. But I would want to give them that space that they buy, but buy a combination of things which they think they want in order that they are absolutely fit. So there is a fine line. I can only go that far, not further, just as they can only go that far, not any further, without compromising each other's interest. And my interest is not different from theirs, because after all, MOD has to take care of the forces as much as defense production.
Madam, Vanakkam. I am Vijay from Satyam News, Tamil News Channel. Madam, இப்போது இந்தியாவில் இருக்கக்கூடிய இந்த பாதுகாப்பு தளவாடங்களை எல்லாமே பெரும்பாலும் இந்தியாவிலேயே அதிகமாக தயாரிக்கப்பட்டு அதற்கான முன்னுரிமைகள் கொடுக்கப்பட்டதாக சொல்லியிருக்கீங்க. அது இல்லாமல் 47 நாடுகள் இருந்து இங்கே வந்திருக்காங்க. இந்த சூழ்நிலையில் இந்தியாவில் தயாரிக்கக்கூடிய இந்த அனைத்து தளவாட பொருட்களுக்கும் மத்திய அரசு துறை எந்த மாதிரியான நிதி ஒதுக்கப்படுகிறது, அவங்களுக்கு மானியங்கள் கொடுக்கறதுக்கான வாய்ப்புகள் இருக்கா? ஏன்னா இந்தியாவில் இருக்கக்கூடிய அனைத்து பாதுகாப்பு தளவாடங்களுமே இந்தியாவில் தயாரிக்கணும் அப்படின்ற ஒரு விஷயம் வரும்பொழுது நிச்சயமாக ஒரு பெருமைக்குரிய விஷயமா இருக்கும். அப்போது எத்தனை மாதிரியான நிறுவனங்கள் இதில் உள்ள வர்றாங்க, வெளியில் காம்படிஷனாக மற்ற நாடுகளை கம்பேர் பண்ணும்போது நம்ம நாடுகள் முழுமையாக எல்லாத்தையும் தயாரிப்பதற்கான ஒரு விஷயங்களை முன்னெடுக்கும் பொழுது அதற்கான நிதி ஒதுக்கீடோ இல்லை மானியங்களோ கொடுக்கறதுக்கான விஷயங்கள் எப்படி இருக்குது? அப்படி இருக்கும் பொழுது முழுக்க நம்மளுடைய இந்த தளவாட பொருட்களை இந்தியாவிலேயே தயாரிக்கிறதுக்கும் மற்ற நாடுகள்லேருந்து இங்கே நிறைய விஷயங்கள் வரும்போது அவங்களுக்கு நிறைய சலுகைகள் கொடுக்குறாங்க, ஏன்னா வெளிநாடுகள்லேருந்து வர்றதுனால. ஸோ அப்படி பார்க்கும்போது வெளிநாடுகள்லேருந்து வரக்கூடிய தளவாட பொருட்கள் கொடுக்குற சலுகையும் உள்நாட்டுகளிலேயே தயாரிக்கக்கூடிய இந்த தளவாட பொருட்கள் பாதுகாப்புக்கான சலுகைகள் எப்படி இருக்குது, மானியங்கள் எவ்வளவு வழங்கிருக்கிறது, அதிகமான ப்ரொடக்ஷனுக்கான என்ன வழிகள் இருக்கு மேடம்?
He is eager to know if for those who are getting, or if for those who are manufacturing defense equipments in India, are we encouraging them by giving them incentives, subsidies, so that they can be better in their production, that will also support them so that they can export. And the question also adds, which I think is a wrong addition, but I will answer him. The question also adds that such subsidies and such assistance are being given for those who come into India and sell or manufacture here. In other words, maybe he is remotely suggesting, na thappu solrena correct pannunga ungalku english puriyum illa, maybe he is suggesting somewhere that they may not be, or currently there is not a level playing field. If Indian manufacturers are doing defense manufacturing of items, can we give them that support through subsidies or some kind of incentive, just as we would give for those who are coming from outside? உங்களுக்கு நான் சொல்ல விரும்புறது என்னன்னா, நாங்க வெளிநாட்டுல இருந்து வரவங்களுக்கு ஒரு விதமான சலுகையும் கொடுக்கறது இல்ல, ஒரு விதமான இன்சென்டிவும் கொடுக்கறது இல்ல. ஆனா அவங்க ஒருவேளை நம்ம சாமான அவங்க கிட்ட இருந்து வாங்கின பிறகு ஆஃப்செட் பாலிசின்னு ஒன்னு இருக்கு, அதன் மூலமாக நாங்கள் இவ்வளோ வாங்குறோம் இல்லை உங்ககிட்ட இருந்து, நீங்களும் நம்ம நாட்டில் வந்து முதலீடு போடுங்க, இல்லை எங்களுக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பு கொடுக்கக்கூடிய அளவில் ஏதாவது இங்கிருந்து சாமான் வாங்குங்க அப்படின்னு ஆஃப்செட் பாலிசின்னு ஒன்று இருக்கு. அது 30% நம்ம வாங்குறதுல 30% இங்கே நீங்கள் வந்து இன்வெஸ்ட் பண்ணுங்கன்னு சொல்லி கூட்டிட்டு வரோம். அது சலுகை இல்லை. நம்ம வாங்குறதுனால அவங்களை இங்கே வந்து வைக்க சொல்றோம், இல்லை வந்து யாரோடையாவது சேர்ந்து கலந்து மேனுஃபேக்சர் பண்ண சொல்றோம், அது சலுகை இல்லைங்க. ஒன்று. ரெண்டாவது, நம்ம நாட்டிலே உற்பத்தி பண்ணுறாங்க, நம்ம நாட்டிலே உற்பத்தி பண்ணி ஏற்றுமதி பண்ணக்கூடிய தகுதி இருக்கிறவங்களா இருந்தாங்கன்னா அவங்களுக்கு ஏன் சலுகை கொடுக்கக்கூடாது அப்படின்ற மாதிரி நீங்கள் கேட்குறீங்க. சலுகைங்கிற வார்த்தை இன்னைக்கு தேதியில் உலகளவில்
பலவிதமா கொடுக்கப்படுகிறது. நீ ஏற்றுமதி பண்ற அதனால சலுகை கொடுக்கறேன் அப்படின்னு சொன்னா அது டபிள்யூடிஓ ரூலுக்கு எகேன்ஸ்டா இருக்கும். ஆனா நீங்க சலுகை வேற விதமா கொடுக்கணுமா கொடுங்க, அதை தடுத்து நிற்கிறதுக்கு யாருமே இல்லை. அதனால டபிள்யூடிஓட நிர்பந்தத்தினால நம்ம சலுகை கொடுக்கறது இல்லைன்னு எடுத்துக்க வேண்டாம். சலுகை கொடுக்கறோம், கொடுப்போம், ஆனா அது ஏற்றுமதி பண்றதுக்கு டைரக்டா ஏற்றுமதிக்கு கொடுக்கறது இல்லை, வேற விதமா கொடுக்கலாம். அது வெளிநாட்டுல இருந்து வரவங்களுக்கு நாங்க எந்த விதமான சலுகையும் இப்ப வரைக்கும் கொடுக்கல, கொடுக்கவும் மாட்டோம். இப்போதைக்கு பாலிசி அந்த மாதிரி இல்லை. அதனால ஆஃப்செட் பாலிசியை நீங்க சலுகையோட கன்ஃபியூஸ் பண்ணிக்காதீங்க. ஐ ஹோப் மை ஆன்சர் இன் தமிழ் இஸ் ஆல் ரைட். டு யூ வாண்ட் மீ டு ரிபீட் இட் இன் இங்கிலீஷ்?
Next, please.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Next, please. Yes. Yeah. We'll come one by one, please.
I am Danveer from Indian Defence Review. And
keep the mic closer.
I am Danveer from Indian Defence Review. My question to you is, ma'am, that there is acute shortage of ammunition with regards to multi-barrel grenade launchers, anti-material rifle and the sniper rifle at infantry battalion level, specially deployed on the line of control. And as per our input, it affects the operations at that end. So what are we doing to overcome this specific shortfall, which is of course not glamorous, so it does not hit the headlines? And secondly, the troops deployed in the valley and on the line of control, they find AK-47 to be the most favorite weapon system. This also comes when the special forces are using TEVOR, which is top of the line supposedly weapon system of the world. Even those troops prefer to carry AK-47 along with them, and that is the mainstay as far as the small arm assault rifle is concerned. My question, the second question is basically, do you have any system of taking direct feedback from the troops deployed, or is it the linear fashion through the headquarters that come filtered at each level? Thank you.
Sir, I am not exactly aware of the kinds of ammunition you have flagged, but suffice it to say that 2 years ago, emergency powers were given to the Armed Forces Headquarters to procure ammunition, whatever kind of ammunition they wanted. And I'll be happy to share with you the details of the kinds of contracting that has been done over the last few years. And now they have also been given special powers to procure weapons, ammunition, over and above the emergency power. That has also been done. So it's very much up to the service headquarters to assess their shortages, requirements, and do the procurement on their own. This power has been given to them unequivocally without ceilings. As to the question of direct feedback from the troops, troops do talk to RM, they do talk to RRM, they do talk to other officers, they do talk to their own officers, but finally, Army is a strictly hierarchical organization, and we prefer to go by the opinion of the service headquarters, as it should be done.
Karthik Kakur from Life Madam, of Soldiers.
Wait, let him answer the question. After 5 minutes.
Karthik Kakur from Life of Soldiers. In regard to the new RFI for the fighter aircraft, a foreign OEM said that the private sector lacks the expertise to handle such a big scale project. Will the government work towards including the DPSUs? If yes, what will be the scope for DPSUs in this?
Sir, as I have already answered to a couple of other people, these are early days. The RFI has just come out. I am not aware of any such concerns expressed by the OEMs, foreign OEMs, regarding the incapability or lack of capability of Indian industry to match up to their requirements. As and when these concerns are raised, we'll come to them, sir.
Yes.
Ma'am, Bipendra from Bloomberg here. Ma'am, I just have this question. So, since the strategic partners policy was introduced last year, since the strategic partners policy was introduced last year, there have been 4 RFIs that have come out, 2 for naval helicopters, 1 for the submarines, and now 1 for the fighter jets. And you know, this government is going into an election in about 10 months time now, and the budget for the next year has already been announced. It's already, we know the budget, we just have about 90,000 crores rupees for the capital procurement. Can you just tell us what sort of a order is likely to happen in the next 1 year from under the strategic partners policy or otherwise, with the limited number of amount of budget that you have? That is my first question, ma'am. And the second question is regarding the defense industrial corridors that you have announced. You have announced 2 industrial corridors, but The contours of those policy, the corridors are not known as yet. Have you formalized what is the what is going to happen in these defense corridors? What are they going to do?
Sir, the strategic partnership is at a preliminary stage. We have brought out the RFIs. They have to be evaluated. They have to go through a long process of evaluation and consultation. We have to look at, you know, transfer of technology. We have to look at the Make in India aspect. So question of orders next year, I am afraid, is a little premature. And so thank you.
Ma'am, Rahul Singh this side from Hindustan Times.
On the defense industry corridor, after the announcement of the two defense industry corridor in the budget speech, we have immediately initiated the process of taking industry feedback on what are the things that will make the ecosystem grow best in those areas. Like I mentioned, we have done a round of consultations in Tamil Nadu, and in the month of April and May, we will be doing similar rounds of consultation in UP. We have also parallelly initiated a process of selecting a top consultant to prepare a detailed project report, and that consultant will be taking all these inputs which we have received, and this process of selection of consultant is likely to be completed within a month, and the DPI should be prepared, in which the specifics of what needs to go into these corridors will be decided.
Ma'am, Rahul Singh this side from Hindustan Times. My question relates to the defense budget. You know, a series of reports were presented in Parliament recently where the Army, Air Force and Navy painted a very grim picture of how they're dealing with lack of resources. They talked about the possibility of a two-front war. They talked about how our neighbors are swiftly modernizing and how we don't have the funds. The defense secretary just talked about the powers of the vice chiefs being increased to, you know, for emergency procurement, but the vice chief himself says that there's no provision for that money. How serious is this situation, considering we are looking at two hostile neighbors and we need to build capabilities very swiftly? Two things happened before Def Expo. One was the award of an order for the bulletproof jackets, 1.86 lakhs, and the RFI, both projects extremely delayed. So in against that backdrop, ma'am, how serious is lack of military budget and the true front challenge? And ma'am, from your Russia trip, if you could give us an update on the FGFA and the S-400, please. Thanks.
Rahul, I'm glad you brought this up again. Not you, but you brought it up here. The Parliamentary Standing Committee has certainly said what you've brought out here, but it has said a lot more. It has said really lot more. And I wouldn't want to throw a challenge here, but certainly that is always in my mind. I wish at least one who's here, anyone who's here, inclusive of us, who can confidently say that they've read the entire Standing Committee's report. That Standing Committee report has to be credited for saying a lot more other things also. I wish anybody from the media goes into the detail of what that Standing Committee report has said, other than what you've quoted now. I'm not disputing anything that you've quoted, but it has said a lot more other things. For instance, like the way you have rightly pointed out about the bulletproof jackets. Raksha Rajya Mantri, in his reply in the Parliament, and also mentioned in the Standing Committee's report which you're referring to, clearly there is a statement saying a certain quantity of the bulletproof jackets have already been delivered. That's because action has already been taken on that front. It's not over-the-counter stuff that I can buy it and deliver it the next day, now that I've seen the Standing Committee report. Action had already been taken. And you also have seen probably in the recent past, probably in the last two or three days, there's a lot of media report on that, that an Indian company has been given the order for manufacturing a large quantity of bulletproof jackets. That again couldn't have been after I saw the Standing Committee report. So things are happening in the ministry. And I would want to credit the vice chief, whose statement that you are quoting, which I understand media can quote, has also said a lot more things about how he's been given the powers now under emergency, which is what the secretary also referred to. He's been given enough financial powers to procure that which he thinks is immediate and emergency requirement. So the standing committee report has many other things also. So there is, I want to use this opportunity to remove the doubt in anybody's mind that nothing is happening in the ministry. On the contrary, from Manohar Parikar's time to Arun Jaitley's time to now, the last just a few months that I've been there, our focus has been prioritize on what we have as a list of what has not been procured in the last 10, 20 years. Prioritize, reprioritize, utilize the available fund to the maximum. And that is why before the budget of 2018, you had the Air Force utilizing more than 103, 104%, am I right? Of all the resources which was given to them. Was that possible otherwise? Decisions are being made. And the army before the budget had already utilized 98% of its budget. And mind you, nowadays budgets are presented earlier and not on 31st March or 29th February. So utilization is critical to budget being utilized fully and being utilized for procurement fully. And therefore, I would want in this bahana, in this excuse, I would want to suggest and invite all of us to please read the standing committee report in full. You'll probably get to know a lot more, which will enable us to answer a lot more on what's happening in the ministry.
Next.
Ma'am, vanakkam, ma'am. Ma'am, Velmurugan from News 18, ma'am. Ma'am, inge, inge.
You're finished.
Russia, maybe this is not my best of times to sit here in the media with the other appointments. I can meet with the media sometime in Delhi to talk in detail about what we've followed up in Russia. I'm glad to say the Russian delegation is here. You can also interact with them. I'm also glad to say that we've had a very fruitful meeting in Russia. I've met up with the Deputy Prime Minister. I've met up with my counterpart, Defense Minister, Mr. Shoigu. I've also met up with the Defense Production Minister. And therefore, I can say that it was one of the very useful visits. The details, of course, I can talk to you when you are back in Delhi.
Hello, ma'am. Vanakkam, ma'am. Velmurugan from News 18, Tamil Nadu. அதாவது 47 நாடுகளுக்கு மேலாக இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போல பங்கேற்று இருக்காங்க. சீனா ஏன் பங்கேற்கல? நீங்க அழைப்பு விடுத்தும் ஏன் நிராகரிச்சிருக்கிறாங்க? அமெரிக்க ஏதாதிபத்தியத்திற்கு கீழே வரக்கூடிய நாடுகள் ஒரு ஒரு அணியா சேரக்கூடிய ஒரு வாய்ப்பு இருக்கா? அப்படிப்பட்ட ஒரு சூழலை ஏற்படுத்துறீங்களா? தொடர்ந்து வந்து அருணாச்சல பிரதேசம் உள்ளிட்ட இடங்கள்ல ஒரு ஆபத்தான ஒரு சூழ்நிலை இருக்கு. இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ அதை வலிமைப்படுத்துவதற்காக பயன்படக்கூடிய ஒரு டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போவா இருக்குமா? சீனாவுடன் இந்த மாதிரியான ஒரு அணுகுமுறை, பிரிவினை ஒரு அணுகுமுறை வந்து ஏன் ஏற்படுது? தொடர்ச்சியா நரேந்திர மோடி அவர்கள் பலமுறை சீனாவுக்கு சென்று ஒப்பந்தங்கள்ல கையெழுத்திட்டு இருக்கிறாரு. அப்படிப்பட்ட சூழ்நிலையில சீனா இந்தியாவுக்கு இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போவுக்கு வராதற்கான காரணங்கள் என்ன?
We have sent invitation to China along with all the other countries. You know, I'm sure, you know, we also cannot participate in every event where we get participation, but why they are not participating, they would be in best position to answer.
நாங்க பல நாடுகளுக்கு இன்விடேஷன் அனுப்புறோம், எல்லாரையும் வரும்படியா கோரிக்கிறோம். ஆனா யார் வந்து பார்ட்டிசிபேட் பண்றாங்களோ பண்றாங்க, சைனா ஏன் வரலன்றதுக்கு நான் காரணம் சொல்ல முடியாது அப்படிங்கிறாரு. நாங்களும் சில வெளிநாட்டில் நடக்கக்கூடிய கண்காட்சிகளுக்கு போறதில்லை. ஏன் இந்தியா பார்ட்டிசிபேட் பண்ணல அதுல அப்படின்னு கேட்க மாட்டாங்க. அந்த மாதிரி ஒவ்வொரு கண்ட்ரிக்கு எப்போ எங்க போய் பார்ட்டிசிபேட் பண்ணோம் அவங்க ப்ரையாரிட்டியில இருக்கோ அது பிரகாரம் வருவாங்க,
அவ்வளவு. இப்போ நம்ம எடுக்கிற இந்த போர் பயிற்சிகள்
நான் இப்ப ரெடியா விவரம் என் கையில இல்லைங்க, கொடுக்குறேன் உங்களுக்கு. அழைப்பிதழ் அனுப்பி ஆனாலும் அவங்க வராம இருக்கக்கூடிய நாடுகள் எத்தனைங்கிறது ஒரு லிஸ்ட் வேணா உங்களுக்கு அப்புறமா கொடுக்குறேன், இப்ப எங்கிட்ட ரெடியா இல்ல.
தற்பொழுது நாம எடுக்கக்கூடிய போர் பயிற்சிகள் சீனாவுக்கு எதிராக எடுக்கிறோமா?
எதுங்க
தற்பொழுது எடுக்கக்கூடிய போர் பயிற்சிகள் தற்பொழுது தீவிரமா நடந்துகிட்டு இருக்கிறதா செய்திகள்ல ஒளிபரப்பிட்டு இருக்கோம்
எங்க
நம்மளுடைய
போர் பயிற்சிகள் எங்க நடந்துட்டு இருக்கு
தொடர்ச்சியாக இந்தியாவுடைய எல்லை பகுதிகளில்
இந்தியாவுடைய எல்லை பகுதிகளில் எங்க நடக்குதுங்க
இல்ல நம்மளுடைய போர் பயிற்சி மேம்
நம்மளோட போர் பயிற்சி பாரத நாட்டோட எல்லையில எங்க நடக்குதுன்னு உங்களுக்கு செய்தி வந்துச்சு
இல்ல அருணாச்சலம் உள்ளிட்ட
அருணாச்சல பிரதேஷ்லயா போர் பயிற்சின்னு அருணாச்சல பிரதேஷ் எல்லையில நடக்கிற மாதிரி எனக்கு ஒன்றும் செய்தி இல்லைங்க ஆனா போர் பயிற்சி எப்படின்னு நீங்க கேட்கறத பார்த்தா சைனாக்கு எதிராக தான் பண்றோமா அப்படின்னா இல்லைங்க போர் பயிற்சிங்கிறது நடக்கும் போது இப்ப அருணாச்சல நடக்குதுன்னு நான்
சொல்லல
ஆனா நடக்கும் போதுன்னு எல்லா விதமான சிச்சுவேஷனுக்கும் ரெடியா இருக்கக்கூடிய அளவுதான் பயிற்சி நடக்கும்
தயாராக இருக்கிறோம் எல்லாத்துக்கும்
தயாரா இருக்கிறதுக்கு தான் எப்பொழுதுமே முயற்சி நடந்துட்டு இருக்குங்க
மேடம் வணக்கம்
kindly restrict to one question each
மேடம் வணக்கம் I am Raja from Tandi TV இந்த கண்காட்சி மூலம் எவ்வளவு வர்த்தகம் நடைபெறும் எதிர்பார்க்கிறீங்க
He is asking what is the quantum I expect to be tied up during this Def Expo. I am no good in numbers. Def Expo moolama நம்ம எத்தனை ஒப்பந்தங்கள்ல கையெழுத்து போடுறோம் ஒவ்வொரு ஒப்பந்தத்துக்கும் ஒரு பணத்துல இவ்வளவு அப்படின்னு சொல்ல முடியுமா அப்படின்னு முடியாது பணம் கான்ட்ராக்ட்ஸ் கமர்ஷியல் கான்ட்ராக்ட்ஸ் நடக்கும் அதை தவிர ஒரு வந்திருக்கிற டெலிகேஷனோட பல விதமான பேச்சுவார்த்தைகளும் நடக்கலாம் வர்த்தக கண்காட்சி அதனால டிஃபென்ஸ் ப்ரொடக்ஷன் செக்ரட்டரி வுட் யூ வாண்ட் டு காமெண்ட் ஆன் இட்
மேம்
There are a lot of commercial agreements and discussions going on. The result of it happens over a period of time. But I would just want to add one thing. There is another aspect to this Def Expo, and that is the economic aspect of the conduct of the expo itself. And at least our understanding is 1,000 crore of economic activity will happen in and around this area because of the conduct of Def Expo here.
Ma'am. Ma'am. Hello.
Ma'am.
Yeah, this is... Ma'am, this is Hema here from DDF.
Ma'am, just wanted to ask you...
Please wait one after the other. I'm coming to you.
Every time we hear the industry always putting up challenges before the government, I just want to understand from a governance perspective, what is the challenge that you see or what is the lacuna in the industry that you see where we are not able to achieve the goals that have been set? I'm saying that we always hear the industry saying that they have a lot of challenges and they have been seeking the government support in various ways. So I would want to ask you from a governance perspective, what is the lens, from your lens, what are the challenges that you see? What are the lacuna that you see in the industry which is not able to help us achieve the position that we would like to?
Defense production, when you take it, there is no surety till we complete the product. That means one has to work for a longer period. Whereas a car manufacturer goes through a survey himself and he knows for himself what is the quantum required. Here, unless otherwise we make the product, go through the process of testing, user trial, which takes a long drawn process, after that only the production order comes in. So that is one of the gestation period which industry should take care of it. I somehow find some of the industries ask me right in the first day, I am working with you, what is the number of product is to be bought? I cannot give you that answer sometime. But madam has created a new Para 72 by which that we are able to tell, in case you and I work together and succeed, this is the quantum wanted. I'm sure with that, a lot of other hurdles can be removed.
Nirmala ji, Pallav Bagla from the Science Magazine and Science Editor, New Delhi Television. Two short questions, ma'am. The Prime Minister speaks of a new India, and the world is also heading for a new world order. What is the role of unmanned vehicles and drones in Indian armament production? If I may add my opinion, It seems we are dragging our feet on unmanned stuff. And the second question to you, what is the status of the INS Arihant and the related nuclear powered submarines and the whole assembly which goes with it?
As regards Arihant, as you know, it is strategic. We will not be able to give you much more details. And whatever you know, it's already there available. As regarding the UAVs concerned, we have got very small minor UAVs which can be used in a function like this to photograph and probably to transmit. And there are larger UAVs like Rustum 2, which is almost like an aircraft. When it comes to the small UAVs, we should encourage the industry, and we will be doing it, to ensure that they themselves produce and find a user or application for it. Whereas the larger one, which goes for a certification process, like an aircraft development, and that needs a huge airport, that needs a lot of infrastructure, there only the government should spend more and more money. Industry should take up a smaller UAVs and produce their own application, and probably with the service also it can be go ahead with that. That's the new India we must convert.
I'm from the Indian Defense Review. A point that the Secretary of Defense Production had brought out, that there is a lot of collaboration between the PSUs and also the private industry. Contrary to what he has said, I feel in my interaction with the private industry is they are finding it very difficult to get the production through, because there is a priority from the Ministry of Defense for giving these orders to the PSUs. And they are being expected to put in a lot of investment, which is not, which they find very difficult since the orders are not forthcoming. The second question, as the Raksha Mantri, Honorable Raksha Mantri had said, that you have left it to the defense forces to decide whether they want to import equipment or take indigenous manufactured equipment. I think, you know, this is a logistic nightmare if you allow this sort of thing to happen. If you want to encourage the local manufacturers, I think you have to put your foot down and say you will accept only indigenous manufactured thing. And it is time, I think, we need to do that. Thank you.
Sir, there are many private sector companies in India which do a solid amount of business in the defense sector, irrespective of what the PSUs are doing. Each have made their own niche, and as far as I can name a lot of them, but I do not wish to, who have very large footprints in the defense sector. There is the question of bias towards PSU does not really exist. In fact, we have actually opened up the sector hugely. We set up a tariff levelization policy last year. We have taken off number of nearly more than 100 products from the OFP list. So there is a lot of scope, but as my colleague Dr. Christopher had said, there is an issue of not being able to see an assured order book in the future till such time your equipment is manufactured and tested according to the requirements of this armed force that is going to use it. And that guarantee nobody can give, not even the PSUs can give that guarantee, not even foreign manufacturers can give that guarantee. Suffice it to say that, sir, we understand the issues of the private sector. Recently, a large number of steps have been taken. In fact, as Dr. Christopher mentioned, we have said that anybody who has a good product that he has developed on his own is most welcome to come to us and put it through the testing protocol. If it passes and if he is the sole player, we'll give him an order, provided we need that thing, you know. And if he's not the sole player, if there's more than one, we'll go for a price bid. So this is a huge step that we have taken, that if you have a good product, it meets our requirements, sir, we will buy it. And of course, as needless to say, if we need it. So sir, we are aware of the concerns that you've raised. You have raised these concerns repeatedly in your publication. We are working towards addressing it, and we hope to interact with you continuously and get some kind of a, you know, reasoned feedback from time to time as to what we are doing. Thank you.
Ma'am, just wanted to ask you,
While coming across the locals, we found that the locals are quite happy to have this destination as the venue for the Deaf Expo. Just wanted to ask if this will, most of the people want to know if this will continue to be in future also. And secondly, ma'am, the Prime Minister is fasting tomorrow. So would he be able to come here? And I think BJP MPs are also fasting along with him. So would you also be fasting, ma'am?
Yes, I will be fasting. The Prime Minister will also be fasting and he is going to be here. The fasting is not going to stop him from coming here. It will go as per schedule. Well, I think that has been answered already. There is no decision on a permanent site for Deaf Expo. Yes, it serves this year, but for future, we don't know yet.
Ma'am, good morning. I'm Suresh Patil. I'm from Pune. Ma'am, our company is Accurate. We are making import substitute quality equipments to maintain the quality of product.
One minute. Did you introduce yourself as a representative of a company?
No, for the MSME, I would like to.
No, right. You're not a patrakar. You're not a media person.
No, I'm not a patrakar.
Then you may have to ask some other time. This is meant for exclusive. I'm so sorry, ma'am. Please. Okay.
Ma'am, Rajiv. This side, ma'am. Ma'am, this side. Rajiv Ranjan, NDTV India. डिफेंस एक्सपो का मैम 10th एडिशन है ये, लेकिन उसके बावजूद जो कई सारी रिपोर्ट आती है, इंडिया जो है सबसे बड़ा इंपोर्टर डिफेंस मैन्युफैक्चरिंग का बना हुआ है हथियारों का, तो ये जो एक्सपो लगा हुआ है, कितना फायदेमंद आपको लगता है, कब ऐसा हो जाएगा कि बैलेंस जो हो पाएगा कि हम ज़्यादा हथियार खरीदे नहीं बल्कि बनाए एक्सपोर्ट करें?
वी हैव ऑलरेडी इनिशिएटेड द प्रोसेस ऑफ मेकिंग India as a major defense manufacturing hub. The draft policy, defense production policy, which has been released for consultation, actually envisions that by 2025, we should be among, we would have gone from importer to exporter. There are several steps that are envisioned there, and we look forward to hearing the comments of everyone on that policy so that we can realize that vision.
मैम, संजीव राठी फ्रॉम यूनिवर्ता. मैडम, रक्षा उत्पादन के क्षेत्र में आत्मनिर्भरता की भारत की क्या स्थिति है और हमारे सामने क्या चुनौतियां हैं? आप क्या समझते हैं किस तरह की चुनौतियां हमारे सामने?
रक्षा उत्पादन में तो हमारी प्राइवेट सेक्टर में बहुत आजकल प्रगति हुई है. सरकारी कंपनियां बहुत DPSUs और OFBs सालों से हैं, मगर एक आध में प्रॉब्लम्स भी हैं. मगर आजकल आप प्राइवेट सेक्टर के प्रगति को आप देखते हुए लगता है कि हमारे लिए आने वाले दिन में मौका, मतलब अपॉर्चुनिटी ज़्यादा, चैलेंजेस कम एक्सपोर्ट करने के लिए.
This is Manish Kumar Jha from Business World. We are aware of a lot of traditional collaboration from DRDO research. I would like to know specific about artificial intelligence, robotics and drones. Can you highlight some of the research which you are doing in these areas specific? Thank you very much.
Vanakkam, madam. Vanakkam. Embeer Praveen Philip, Vin Tolai Kaatchiyil Irundhu Kelkiren. சுமார் 800 கோடிக்கு மேலாக செலவிட செய்யப்பட்டு நடத்தப்படுகிற இந்த கண்காட்சி நாட்டினுடைய பாதுகாப்பை வலுப்படுத்துவதற்காக எடுக்கிற முயற்சி பாராட்டுக்குரியது. எனினும் கூட இதன் மூலமாக நேரடியாகவும் மறைமுகமாகவும் எத்தனை இளைஞர்களுக்கா அடுத்த கட்டமாக வேலைவாய்ப்புகளுக்கு உதவுகிற தளமாக இது அமையும் என்பதான பதிவை உங்கள் தெரிந்து கொள்ள விரும்புகிறேன்.
இதன் மூலமா நாட்டில் வெளிநாட்டிலிருந்து வரக்கூடிய இன்வெஸ்ட்மெண்ட் அதிகரிக்கும். உள்நாட்டிலே இருக்கக்கூடிய இந்த உற்பத்தியாளர்களுக்கு வெளிநாட்டுக்கு ஏற்றுமதி பண்ணுறதுக்கான வாய்ப்பு கிடைக்கும். அதோடு இல்லாமல் உள்நாட்டிலேயே சில கருவிகளை உற்பத்தி பண்ணுறவங்களுக்கு இன்னும் மேலும் நல்லா இருக்கக்கூடிய டெக்னாலஜியை யார்கிட்ட இருந்து வாங்கினா நல்லா இருக்கும்ன்றதை பார்த்து வாங்கிறதுக்கான ஒரு சந்தர்ப்பம் இங்கே கிடைக்கும். இதன் மூலமாக அவங்க உற்பத்தி திறனும் பெருகும்,
இது எல்லாத்தையும் நீங்க கண்ணில் வச்சு பார்த்துட்டீங்கன்னா வேலை வாய்ப்பும் சரி உற்பத்தியும் பெருகிறதுக்கான வாய்ப்பு இருக்கு. அதனால இதன் மூலமா நம்ம செலவு பண்றது நீங்க சொன்னாலும் பொது செலவு, பொதுமக்களுடைய நலன் கோசம் நடக்கக்கூடிய செலவு, இதன் மூலமா நம்ம எக்கனாமிக்கலி இந்த இந்த ரீஜனுக்கு நம்ம நாட்டுக்கு நல்லது நடக்கும், வேலை வாய்ப்பு கிடைக்கும். அது எத்தனை அப்படின்னு இன்னைக்கு சொல்ல முடியாது, ஆனா அந்த வாய்ப்புகளுக்கான அவகாசம் இங்க இருக்கு.
வணக்கம் மேடம். பிரசன்னா, தந்தி டிவி. மேடம், ஒரு சில செய்திகள் வருது. என்னன்னா, கடந்த முறை கோவாவில் நடந்தப்போ வந்து ஒரு 234 மேற்பட்ட ஃபாரின் கம்பெனிஸ் கலந்துக்கிட்டாங்கன்னோ, பட் இந்த முறை வந்து ஒரு 150 மேற்பட்ட கம்பெனிகள் மட்டுமே வந்து வந்திருக்கிறதும், கடந்த முறையை காட்டிலும் ஒரு 10% குறைவாக இந்த முறை இருக்குன்னு ஒரு சில செய்திகள்லாம் வந்துட்டு இருக்கு. அப்படின்னா இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ அதை வந்து கம்ப்ளீட் பண்ணுற மாதிரி இருக்குமா, இல்லை அதை அதை விட ஒரு செட் குறைவாக இருக்குமா மேடம்?
நீங்கள் அதை சொல்றதோட சேர்த்து இந்த முறை கோவாவோட நம்ம நாட்டில் உற்பத்தி பண்றவங்களுக்கான வாய்ப்பு அதிகமாக கொடுத்துருக்காங்கன்றதையும் சேர்த்து சொன்னால் ரொம்ப அழகா இருக்கும். அதே சொல்லுங்க. ஏன்னா மோடி அரசின் மூலமாக மேக் இன் இண்டியாவுக்கு முக்கியத்துவம் கொடுக்குற இந்த நேரத்தில் நம்ம நாட்டுக்காரங்களுக்கு ஒரு விதமாகவும் பண்ணறது இல்லைங்க. வெளிநாட்டுக்காரங்களை கூப்பிட்டு வச்சு அவங்க கிட்ட இருந்து வாங்குறீங்க அப்படின்னு சொல்ற அதே நேரத்தில் நம்ம ஏற்றுமதிக்கு நம்ம உற்பத்தி பண்ணக்கூடிய நம்ம ஆட்களுக்கு வாய்ப்பு கொடுக்குறோமான்றதையும் பார்த்துக்கணும். இந்த தரம் பண்ணிருக்கிற இந்த டிஃபென்ஸ் எக்ஸ்போ மூலமாக நம்ம நாட்டில் இருக்கக்கூடிய சிறு குறு தொழிலாளி உற்பத்தி செய்யக்கூடிய கம்பெனிகளுக்கு ஒரு வாய்ப்பு கொடுக்குறோம். அதே சமயம் எப்பவும் போல அவங்க வந்து நம்ம கிட்ட விற்கக்கூடியவங்க வருவாங்க. அவங்க ஒரு 10 குறைஞ்சிட்டாங்கன்றதுனால அவங்க அவங்களோட விற்பனை அவங்க உடம்ப மாட்டாங்க. அட் த சேம் டைம் நம்ம நாட்டுக்காரங்களுக்கு அவங்களோட இன்ட்ராக்ட் ஆகிறதுக்கான ஒரு வாய்ப்பு நம்ம கொடுக்குறோம். அதனால இது புதுவிதமா நீங்க அதை பார்க்கணும். அதனாலதான் நான் முதல்லயே அந்த வாய்ப்பை சொன்னேன் உங்களுக்கு.
இல்ல மேடம், இப்ப கடந்த முறையை காட்டிலும் இதை எப்படி நம்ம வித்தியாசமா பாக்குறது, இதற்கான வாய்ப்பு எங்கெங்கெல்லாம் விரியும் சொல்லி எதிர்பார்க்கறீங்க?
நான் ஆரம்பத்துல சொன்னதெல்லாம் அதாங்க. நீங்க இல்லீங்களா, கொஞ்சம் லேட்டா வந்தீங்களா? இல்லீங்களே, நம்ம ஆரம்பிக்கும் போதே சொன்னேன் அதுதான். இந்த தரம் வெளிநாட்டில இருந்து வந்து விற்பனை செய்யக்கூடிய அந்த கம்பெனிகள் முன்ன போல எப்பொழுதும் வர்றது போல இப்பவும் வந்திருக்காங்க. ஆனா இந்த தரம் முக்கியத்துவம் நம்ம நாட்டிலே உற்பத்தி பண்றவங்களுக்கு சலுகையில இங்க அவங்க ஸ்டால வச்சு அவங்களுடைய பொருட்களையும் டிஸ்பிளே பண்ணி அவங்களும் அவங்களுடைய உற்பத்தி திறனையும் ஏற்றுமதி திறனையும் காட்டுறதுக்கான வாய்ப்பு கொடுக்கறோம். அதுதான் முக்கியமான வித்தியாசம்.
Thank you,
ma'am. One last question, please. Okay.
I didn't hear. You may have said it. I didn't hear your introduction. Would you please repeat it? And for every question, answers given the way in which the panel feels fit.
Yes.
We would have heard your question. Silence could be the answer. And if you want an answer further than that, that's it. Please introduce yourself again.
Yeah, this is Manish Kumar from Business World.
Business World.
Business World, yeah.
Thank
so
you.
I asked a specific question about...
Yes, we know you asked a question on artificial intelligence. We heard it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, yeah.
Good afternoon, ma'am. This is Ashish from NewsX. The allocation in the budget for defense in terms of number is slightly better as compared to last year. But if you see in terms of percentage vis-a-vis GDP of the country, it's as low as something, the lowest in last half a century. How hopeful you are that you will be able to increase the budget allocation with the finance ministry for the upcoming years? There's a lot of conclusion being drawn in the industry, both in the PSU and in the private sectors as well, that maybe because the government has entered into the election mode, so the defense is not in the priority as it was the last 4 years. And second, I have asked this question to all the three chiefs, but as the defense minister, how imminent this threat of 2 or 2.5 front war is and how prepared we are for it?
Sir, on the question of resources, sir, let me assure you that resources are adequate at this point of time. In addition, to supplement your figure about the percentage of GDP, nearly 33% of Government of India's this year's capital budget has been earmarked for defense. I repeat, sir, 33% of Government of India's capital expenditure has been reserved for defense. That's a very large amount, sir. GDP, I am afraid, may not be a good numerator to determine the allocation for defense. Let's not get into the details. Suffice it to say, sir, whatever the armed forces need to maintain and keep up their operational capability, we have provided the resources. Last year and the year before that were the only 2 years in the recent history that we have fully managed to utilize our existing allocation. That has also to be kept in mind. So this year the allocation has gone up, and we entirely hope to fully utilize that allocation, keeping in view our overall priorities. We need to prioritize the requirement. Just to say that we should match whatever the US does or China does or whatever it does needs to also factor in the economic, well, size of the economy as a whole and the size of, you know, their business dealings as a whole. So their resources are not a problem as far as the armed forces are concerned. I reiterate that again and again, whether it's for ammunition, whether it's for capital equipment.
On behalf of Secretary Defense Production and Department of Public Relations, I would like to thank Madam Nirmala Sitharaman, Honorable Defense Minister of India, for having addressed the press conference and answered all the queries very patiently. I also thank Dr. Subhash Bhamre, Honorable Minister of State for Defense, for having graced this occasion. Special thanks to Defense Secretary Shri Sanjay Mitra and Dr. Christopher, Secretary DRDO, for being with us in this press meet and answering queries. Thanks are also due to Secretary Defense Production and his entire team for organizing this event. I shall be failing in my duty if I don't thank HAL authorities and Wiscraft and my entire DPR team for relentlessly working this to make this happen. And special thanks to Doordarshan and ANI for live streaming this. Last but not the least, sincere and heartfelt thanks to all the media friends for having acceded to our request and making it in large numbers. I must say that we, as on date, we have more than 1,000 media registrations to participate in the Defence Expo, and in large numbers you have participated. Thank you very much. Thank you one and all for being with us, and now I invite all of you to join us for lunch at ITC Chola. May I request the media friends to kindly display the passes while entering. The media is requested to show the ID card, enter ITC Chola for dinner, for lunch with RM, please. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.
Podige, Samugatin Magichi.